Hello, everybody. Welcome to Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. It's already started out a bit crazy. We're having some Mercury retrograde effects, technical difficulties and stuff, but we're braving through it in this brave new world. We're here to, most of the PSEC crew here anyway. Kristen did try to join, but she couldn't get beyond her technical difficulties, but we are here with Mel V of Conscious Consumer Network on so she could tell us what that's all about. A little bit ago, we were on her show, so this is, you know, kind of par for the course. And I think a great focus that we had like just before the show that we can move into is we've all noticed that it can be very challenging to create those those consciousness networks, because we've all got these paradigms that society has put into us about not being worthy and not being deserving. So when the good things pop up, you know, we're like, oh, when's the other shoe gonna drop? Is this too good to be true? Or am I gonna get betrayed? Or, oh, good things are nothing more than not seeing misery creeping up on you so it can come and rape you. I'd rather sit here in the misery that I could see around me and I can navigate and I know it's there. So I think that's one of the things that's been in the way of bringing people together that we're really facing and moving through now. So why don't you tell us a bit about your experiences in that, Mel? And Mel also used to work for Satan, I mean the BBC. So she was sharing some previous experiences with that.
Yeah, let's think. I actually worked for a number of very toxic industries, fashion, media, sales and marketing, the trifecta of Satan, needless to say. My husband's very much the same, banking, you know, you name it. We've come from the dark side, but in so doing, we lived in London for 10 years. I'm South African, and we've kind of went through a phase of being in a position of, okay, either we are going to integrate ourselves into the darkness or we're going to move away from it and find something else. And at the time that I made that decision, I didn't know what that something else was. All I know is there was something distinctly very wrong with the reality around me. And there's a numerous interesting things that happened that caused my so-called awakening, which wasn't... although it had always been a gradual process, there were various very key things that facilitated that process. And now here I am working in free and independent media with in a completely sort of, I suppose, anti-media stance. So completely fighting everything that I thought I ever wanted, which was a career in mainstream media. And now I'm kind of like, well,
sorry to interrupt, Kristen. Kristen, could you mute when you're not talking? Oh, she's got to put in her. Hey, Kristen. Kristen,
can you guys hear me?
Yeah, now we can. Kristen, can you mute when you're not talking, because we're getting a little bit of weird feedback. Like yes. it's not too horrible, but if you could mute when you're not talking, that would be awesome.
Okay, I was wondering why I couldn't hear you guys, but I got it now.
Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Hello, by the way, Kristen. Nice of you to join us. Sorry, Dave, what was your question before that?
I'm trying to unmute.
You're unmuted.
Oh, okay. It still says I'm muted. Weird. We're getting all sorts of glitches. So you can hear me okay? Oh, now it's saying I'm unmuted. Wow, technology's being a total weirdo today. We were just kind of going over the idea of how, you know, paradigms about our self-worth that society has put into us is one of the things that has been a challenge facing in regards to coming together with, you know, creating these more conscious communities to work together to, you know, to create the more positive change. Because when good things start to happen, we tend to see it as like, oh, well, the other shoe's going to drop and that good thing isn't really that good. It's all going to fall apart. It's all going to fail. It always happens. I'm just setting myself up. I may as well just stay saturated in the misery that I can see around me, that I know how to navigate, that has been my norm. And it's been a part of, you know, the mind matrix. And I'd like to know about whatever experiences you've had within that and facing those challenges of bringing people together and facing your own paradigms and the paradigms of others and all the various paranoias and suspicious, like, oh, if it's a good thing, if you're talking about unity, that's the new world order. Oh, we can't have unity. I mean, that's a familiar one, right?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think people are programmed generally with a lot of fear. So even if you come to them with something that shows them definitive truth based on empirical fact, or you show them solutions for their perils, even the thought of change frightens them more than actually potentially ending up in a better situation through having taken the risk and gone down, you know, the path less trod. And this is really now where we're sitting. You said it so eloquently earlier, David, the fuck it point, you know, those of us who are sick of things the way they are ready now to take the risk and make the change. And it's we really have to find that positive space within us. And you asked for examples within my own life, within my own being. I work in media. I can just tell you, you want me to pull out the huge list of dramas and things and peoples and whatever else is that I've experienced. Each and every one of them have served their purpose in teaching me, and me learning from them, and me being able to teach them. And that's the way I choose to look at this. But I do recognize very much that humanity is intensely, intensely broken through bad programming in a very negative paradigm. And this can be very difficult when you're dealing with people who have been through a lot of drama. And we've got quite a few broadcasters on Conscious Consumer Network who have very hectic pasts. People who have been MK Ultra, sex slaves, that kind of thing, you know, used by the government in their various mind control operations. I mean, that's the worst kind of abuse you can put upon someone, is the abuse of the mind, the manipulation of the mind to the point where they render their body to the point where they will allow pain and, you know, violation. So, you know, the beauty of working with these people, first off, it can be very, very hectic because they can flip into their altars and they can attack you. And I've kind of learned, you know what, sometimes when people come at you, you need to understand what's driving them instead of just attacking back. And that's one thing that's been a very good lesson for me with this network. You're working with people who have such extreme personalities in terms of my team. I can't even tell you how different everybody is from each other. That's also good because it's what creates the variety in the work that we do. You know, we wouldn't have kept going for so long if everything was the same. But at the same time, you have a lot of people who come and who are very insecure, very broken, very sad, very hurt, and who do need a lot of building up and who do need a lot of encouragement. And that is one of the things we try to do in creating a Conscious Consumer Network, was to create a support network for those people who want to come out and say something, who have a voice, but they need a little bit of support behind them, a little bit of training, and just something to help them get to that step where it can be professionally done. So it's a multi-integrational process that we engage in with Conscious Consumer Network, not only in the way we face new paradigm media, but also in the way we've created the operational structure, which is all based on consent. I don't tie people into contracts. Down to the way in which I mentor, train, and coach people who require it, mostly into an empowering mindset, because you cannot do this work unless you feel empowered. But those people who are working from a self-deprecating, disempowered space are the ones who attract the vampiric astral entities that you can't see that suck all your energy. It's part of the mindset to create the positive sort of energy around you that keeps you vibrant, charged, and obviously keeps all those negative, aberrant energies at bay. You're muted, David. David, you're muted.
Yeah, I'm trying to unmute it, so it's being a little glitchy. Okay, one thing that I've noticed that has been a big problem within people trying to to seek the more positive is they shun the dark, which is about the darkest thing that you can do, instead of facing the dark and shining light in the dark and having compassion within those dark places. It's like, oh no, you're so negative, you're so low vibration, I have to get away from you. And in so doing, they're completely avoiding all of the stuff within them that they need to face and integrate and balance out and come to harmony with them. So they don't realize that the mind matrix is still co-opting the hell out of them, because they're trying to put this thin layer of, you know, positivity over this vast sea of negativity. So they go into like this false positive dichotomy, and they end up being very, very apathetic and very cruel. And they take everybody's difference in perspective is, oh, you're bullying me, you're manipulating me, you're, you know, this, that, and so on. And they get very paranoid, increasingly paranoid, while trying to be in this positive love and light, etc. And it just intensifies that internal, you know, battle inside of them. I've seen this dichotomy not only within, you know, the truth movement as well. Like, oh, it's positive to fight the New World Order. It's like, well, wait a minute, but how are you fighting it? You're becoming it. You're falling for all of the tricks and traps. You're on such a high level of arrogance. You're thinking, oh, I'm awake. None of that could possibly affect me. I couldn't possibly fall for anything. I'm awake. Yet all this division is being created and stuff. And, you know, I think that really the true positive is to face and integrate and heal, you know, that negative. Otherwise, it creates a negative feedback loop. You start feeling mad about being mad about being mad about being mad, sad about being sad about being sad, etc. Okay, seeing as Kristen walked away. Katerina and Paul, why don't you you share some of your experiences in facing these various aspects and working your way out of the traps. And not to say that you're fully out, none of us are fully out, but you know, your journey so far in that. And then we'll get to Kristen next, and she can share her experiences in that.
Sounds good. Okay, so, oh, and we are good to know. So I used to deal with anger a lot. In fact, you know, you talked about the negative feedback loop, angry about being angry about being angry about being angry. And that was definitely a place that I used to live. And I felt like I was defective because of it. And so once I stopped judging my own anger and I said, wait, this anger is just some energy trying to be expressed, that's when life was able to get a whole hell of a lot better. Because it was simply expansion seeking expression at that point, rather than, well, I have this negative part of my personality that's bad and needs to be hidden, or there's this part of me that's defective or dysfunctional. And really the integration has been hugely, hugely beneficial for me, because it's allowed me to realize, hey, when I'm angry, that's telling me something. When I'm sad, that's telling me something. And instead of shunning the dark, I actively invite it. I look for it, and I see it in other people because I see where I used to be, and I can have great compassion for them. And so really, when you shun the dark, it separates you from other human beings. Whereas when you choose to integrate the dark, when you choose to look at it, shine some light in the dark, like the lighthouse is out on the rocky outcropping, and it doesn't just sit there, like it has a light. And when people see the light, they know that there is danger. We call it the lighthouse, not the dark house. And so it's very important. Once, you know, what the lighthouse is doing is altruistic. The lighthouse is just being there and saying, hey, there's danger, there's danger, there's danger. Don't come over this direction. I've already been over here. I can tell you what's here. In some ways, you have to go where the danger is. You have to go where the contrast is. You have to go where what you perceive as dark is, so that you can warn other people about it. Instead of just saying, oh, no, I'm not going to go there. And then it becomes this mysterious thing. And, you know, the human mind loves mystery. So it becomes this mysterious thing where you become unnaturally attracted to it. and consequently it's becoming attracted to you because you're just refusing to look at it and see what the heck it is.
Yeah, you're kind of becoming the firefighter that's going into the burning building, helping people out, instead of being the person in the burning building, in the closet, cowering with your hands over your head, going, "Oh my God, the smoke and fire is going to get me."
Thanks for the future advertisement on my future career there, Dave.
Yeah, Richard is going to school for that. Katerina, what would you like to say?
I just wanted to talk about the experience that I had. You know, Dave has been my best friend for 6 years now almost, and he took me like through all of my paradigms, really, like from me being a fibromyalgia girl and having like an intense sense of victimization and an intense sense of self-loathing, because I also, you know, was sexually abused as a kid and had all sorts of like negative programming about my own worth. And being able to go through that whole journey of facing all of my demons and facing all of the stories and the ideas, and just, you know, being able to meet it head on without turning away, without feeling the need to like run from myself anymore, was so intensely liberating, but also extremely scary. And it was probably the scariest stuff I've ever done in my whole life, to face paradigms and to overcome that stuff, and to choose to see the programming for what it is rather than needing to feel like an eternal victim. So yeah, that's been my experience.
Alrighty. You can all hear me, right? Okay, this is weird.
I can hear you.
Ah, there we go. And now I'm hearing stuff, like my sound like cut out for a second.
I did give you the thumbs up because I can't hear you.
Okay, cool. Kristen, recently you've had a very contrasty situation that you've faced that really, you know, you put yourself into a state of, you know, empowerment to where, you know, you took responsibility and you were just like, no more of this. I'm not going to be a victim of this anymore. And you really stood up for yourself. Would it be okay to ask you to talk about that experience and what you've learned and show us the positive aspects of that negative experience that your mind has been going into?
Can you turn the volume down on that, please? I'm about to talk on this call. Okay. I pardon if there's any background noise because I'm in the living room with my cousin and my brother right now. So basically, well, I'm going to start off by saying I'm really nervous to talk right now. I'm nervous about joining in any call. Like, I just don't like putting my voice out there really at all. I do better when it's through text versus when people can actually hear my voice. I know that's pretty common. So I apologize if this is hard to understand or a little bit PC.
I think you speak very, very
with my father to where
I think
he
you
was
speak
supposed
very
to
well.
Help pay for my insurance and give me some money if I agreed to get confirmed in the Catholic Church. And I am not Catholic. I'm a very spiritual person, but in no way Catholic. And basically, he told me he wasn't going to give me some money for my grandmother unless I got confirmed, blah, blah, blah. And then, so I agreed to that. But then I decided I wanted to get confirmed by taking adult classes. And he did not like that at all. And he basically went off on me and told me that he wasn't going to give me the $790 even if I got confirmed doing the adult classes, and he was going to take away my car insurance. So I decided to take a break from going over to my father's house and dealing with him at all, and just basically just accept not getting the money because things got pretty bad that night, physically and verbally, just completely abusive. So I decided to step out of that, and it's been really hard because he is trying to paint me as if I was completely in the wrong right now, and he essentially lied to everyone about what happened, and he has exaggerated it to the point where I'm the one in the wrong and he's not in the wrong, and that is really, really hard. And, you know, I've talked to Dave a lot because he is very good at handling situations where things are hectic as hell and essentially like pitted against you. And he knows how to deal with the law at the same time as dealing with just really aggressive like family circumstances. So I've been talking to him a lot, and he's heard a lot about me overcoming it, you know, deciding to be the bigger person and just leave and essentially not be the one to scream, not be the one to hit back, just leave. And I guess that's good as far as where, you know, how I'm improving. I don't scream back anymore. I stay diplomatic, but being honest, you know, I can't help but feel really, really pissed off and just honestly victimized about it. I can't sit here and pretend like I'm in victimization mode most of the time. So I'm not really the best person to talk about this topic right now, but I will say, as opposed to totally taking everything and, you know, going into self-loathing mode, I do see it for what it is now more often than not. But I do, you know, have a hard time with saying it's not true. I understand that it is self-victimization, but most of the time, you know, it just is true to me. Like, the idea that, you know, I'm worthless and not going to amount to anything, it's usually true for me.
Hey, Kristen.
So, Kristen. I do have moments of great clarity, though, and it's where usually those are brought on by me saying, I'm the only one who will ever really know who I am. I'm the only one who can love me to the fullest because I know everything I am, and everything I've ever experienced has come from me. So, kind of, when I get into that, when I understand that, it's like, I realize the responsibility is on me. It's just usually, do I have the courage? Do I have the goal to accept that responsibility and then go out and live it? It's kind of really, it's painful as it is, but then it's painful to accept that, you know, you can't blame everyone. And it's painful to accept that some amount of the suffering that you've been going through is amount of yourself, you know, adding it on to yourself. So I guess that's where I'm at. I have really big escape issues. I basically am a huge emotional eater and just totally spend way too much time online. I usually avoid going out ever with friends just because those are kind of like my addictions, my escape mechanisms. And then that's usually what it comes out as. But when I'm feeling good, I end up usually posting more online about positive stuff. I might try to make friends with other people, try to do more socially. That's kind of my perspective. I don't really know much more to say on it.
Kristen, can you hear me?
Hey, Kristen?
I couldn't hear you guys because I took my headphones out.
Yeah, we tried to get your attention several times. But
oh, my God.
Kind of a fail. what I was trying to say, Kristen,
I'm so sorry.
It's okay. You speak perfectly fine. Sometimes you have this idea that, oh, you're not allowed to speak unless everything is absolutely perfect and you have to be perfect and show the world you're perfect. Otherwise, if I'm not being perfect, I can't speak. Well, the world doesn't need more fake gurus. They need authentic people to speak exactly as well as you just spoke and being completely real. And one thing you have a hard time accepting, and I've told you over and over again, is that what you say and the way you speak and the message you have to put out is exactly what is needed. It's just that you don't believe me most of the time because that little inner Nazi, that inner three-year-old, that victimized self says, no, Dave can't be right. That no, I need to be perfect. Otherwise, I can't talk. But the world needs people to see that there are people such as yourself that are brave enough to get up there and be vulnerable and tell it like it is. And when you're in these modes, you're just telling it like it is. And that's what's needed. they don't need some perfectly eloquent college professor speaking perfectly about politically correct things. They need people to just be real. And Kristen, you are completely real. And hey, I think that everything you just said is awesome, and it's real, and it's true, and it's from the heart.
Kristen, I also want to add, it's totally normal to be emotional. It's totally normal to go through this right now. It's totally normal. There's nothing wrong with it at all. You know, you're going through the journey right now. This is one of those moments where you're dealing with a lot of stuff, a lot of shit, a lot of crap, you know, and you've got a lot of mental figuring and sorting to do. I've gone through it. I've been through it. I've been in your shoes, mm-hmm. exactly where you're at. A sobbing puddle mess. I've been there. I've
Me
done
too.
That. I've been there.
Me too.
You know, Mr. Big Male, military intimidating, Soviet flag waving, Jefferson flag waving, patriotic. The doctor said I might have patriotic cancer because I pissed red, white, and blue, and I told him to shut his commie mouth because America. I've been there. I have been there in your shoes. I have been there. I know how. There's absolutely no shame whatsoever in coming online and loving it and saying what you're saying right now. Keep you proud of yourself because you are doing it. You're calling it for what it is, and you know, you have emotions, you're showing it on screen, and that is braver than 99.999% of people. You came online and you said it, you are calling it, you are doing it, and I have 100% support for you. So I'm giving you a bravo.
Thanks, Rich.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Hey, Melanie, would you chime in with a few words for Kristen of support and her authenticity so that she can see that everything she said here is absolutely perfect and she didn't do anything wrong?
There's something coming through from the other side.
You are.
Besides me. I've also had a number of abuses from family, so I totally get the pain that comes with it. And the violation from people you trust is horrible. Physical abuse, mental abuse, emotional abuse, to me, it can't really be separated, except physical abuse, the scars are more obvious. But with emotional and psychological abuse, it lasts that much longer, the scars that you can't see. There is, you know, I come across a lot of very abused and broken people with the work that I do, and there's never any easy answer except that this is what you need to go through because it's all part of what you need to become and what you are becoming. Having been abused myself, it's one of the things that made me strong. And again, a very good point David made earlier on, we can't ignore the darkness because I can tell you, it is actually from some of the most horrible things that I've learned some of the best lessons that I've gotten the most strength. So I know it's shit while you're going through it. And I know this is such a cliche, but what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And you must just allow yourself to feel that pain and know that it's serving a purpose. Okay, it's evolving you in a direction. And I tell you, there's a lot of it's unfortunate. I'm sorry. I really didn't enjoy that story about your father wanting you to be confirmed as a Catholic, because I'm just like anybody being indoctrinated into a religion to me is another form of abuse. And then, of course, using material things to try and coerce you, like your car. My mom and dad used to take my car away from me if I didn't do what they wanted. And I freaking hated it. You know, and as a result, there was a dystopian kind of relationship that developed, and I stopped trusting them because I just – you know, that's the worst freaking thing you can do, is to hurt a child, to use material things to convince them over to your way, particularly something like a religious or a belief system, which for you, my girl, must be a personal calling. Whatever you choose it is, whatever you choose to do in terms of your spirituality, where you want to lay your beliefs and how you want to practice your life, it's got to be completely at your discretion. It's got to be completely your choice and your free will. The thing is that the Catholic Church has done this for so long. They have persecuted people, and I come from a group of people, the Huguenots, who were refugees who escaped Roman Catholic persecution from Europe and then escaped to South Africa to go on to become the winemakers and the farmers that settled in the Cape. So I know the history and how pernicious it is, and the fact that it still kind of goes on today. And it's interesting that people are that brainwashed that they would alienate their own family using material objects, using financial means, try and coerce them into a very satanic belief system. Okay, these people do the most horrific things to children. You know, everything from blood drinking, cannibalism, rituals, human sacrifice. And if you want to check out any of my work on that, please check out dragonology.info. I've got a huge body of work put together about that. So I've just got a lot of compassion and empathy for you, and I feel very sorry for you that this has happened to you. And I think it's very, very poor on your father's behalf to force you into doing something like this. And I'm very proud of you for deciding to step away and not, you know, feel the need to succumb because of financial. I think you're much stronger than most people for doing that.
Hell yeah. I mean, bravery is not a lack of fear. It's, you know, it's facing it head on and moving through it. And Kristen is very brave. She just doesn't always realize it. She's not always in the headspace to realize that. By the way, I also find it really amusing that organized Christian religion goes directly against most of what Christ actually said. But then you try to bring that up to them. Hey, what happened to being loving and forgiving and yes. love your neighbor and all that? And they're like, no, screw you. La, 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 la. Like, oh, how very Christian-like. Wow, you're a fine example. And even Jesus was against conversion. Jesus said, don't convert people. It has to be done on their own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I actually have a really
Richard was trying to ask something, if he can go first.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, sorry about that, Paul. I have something that's, I think, really relates to what Kristen's going through with the whole financial thing, and I think Dave knows where I'm going to go with this. So in 2014, Dave was that you want to talk about universal perfect timing. Dave was right where he needed to be, right at the perfect time. In 2014, you want to talk about psycho behavior and neurosis. Well, my stepmother, or my former stepmother, I don't even really consider her family anymore because family doesn't do those sorts of things. But she filed a restraining order on me for emotionally expressing myself. Dave was there for the whole thing. I went into like a 2-hour kind of tangent on my whole family dysfunction, kind of like Kristen just did, only it was a little bit more drawn out. But anyway, she became so enraged and felt threatened by that video and her own victimization that she did what she did. And anyway, the whole year went by. It was just fine. You know, I've got my rights back. Everything in the long run turned out to be just fine. The universe just put me through that needed journey of a test, as it were, that growth period. You know, like you've got to learn how to jump off the metaphorical cliff into the abyss, you know. And I survived and I grew from it. But that coercion, it's something I know very well. Christmas of last year, in fact, my father kind of made this desperate little, like, it was pretty pathetic. It was sad. I mean, we're on better terms now. We're kind of starting to talk and, you know, get back into kind of a more functional, trying to make it work again sort of thing. Just me and him anyway. but anyway, this was before we had started that reinitiation process with some professional help. But basically, he bought, it was an ounce of silver and a Air and Space magazine subscription from the Smithsonian. And, you know, he presented those things to me just totally anonymously through via third party. And he didn't even have the guts to come up to me and say, you know, hey, son, I'm sorry, you know, or at least try to make it some sort of apology. No, this had nothing to do with that. It wasn't even an apology gift. It was kind of one of more of those societally expected appeasement sort of things. But the thing is, the Air and Space subscription was addressed up to his house, which is, in fact, where the psycho crazy lady lives. And it's like, Yeah, if you resubmit to her, you can read all these Air and Space magazines because na-na-na-na-na. And I'm just sitting there going, how pathetic, how stupid do you think I am? I told you no, I'm done with that crap. I'm done with you until you realize that I'm done with that crap and I'm not going back. You know, Dave saw my Declaration of Independence, my verbal Declaration of Independence from that crap. I declared full independence from the tyrannical fourth parental right.
It was a carrot on a stick. Instead of sending the subscription to Richard's house, it's like, oh, well, you can have it if you come here and submit to Queen Hitler. You know, it's like, what? And then on top of it, after the whole thing was over, his stepmother was amazed. Richard should have been coming back, learning his lesson and begging my forgiveness. Why isn't he back begging my forgiveness? Talk about a total sociopath.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, so I totally understand where Kristen's coming from. It's like, it's that threat of, you know, they're like, oh, well, if you bend over and let us stick the pineapple up your asshole, you'll get all these appeasement gifts. Yeah. You know, it's like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not doing that, period. You know, it's not happening ever, as in ever, as in no, as in I'm done with that stuff. I said, fuck you. And I said, fuck this. I'm not, you know, that situation no longer applies to me. I want to become I want to be stronger. I want to be better. I want to grow. I want to, you know, I want to expand, grow my wings and, you know, fly the coop. I want to see what I'm made of, you know. And 2017, this year, in another couple of weeks, I'm going to be going into my first EMT course and stuff. And I'm going to be starting to do all of the necessary training to get my EMT licensure and all that stuff through the state of Oregon and the nationally accredited program and all of that stuff. So, I mean, it's all happening perfect timing. And, you know, this whole class, you know, that's coming up, I'm super nervous about it. And I'm honest about that. I'm owning that. I'm super nervous. I'm scared in some ways because it's like, you know, the malware pops up in your brain. Am I ready to do this? Am I ready to handle this? Can I do this? Can I do this? Can I do this? You know, in the past, you know, the older versions of myself, I wasn't able to keep up with this much. How am I going to be able to yada, 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 you know, and on and so forth. And, you know, now here it is, it's time to jump, it's time to fly, you know, it's, you know, it's like, I'm on the metaphorical stratospherical balloon in a space suit, and here I am leaning out over the edge looking down, and it's like, okay, if nothing goes right, where am I going to end up, you know? It's kind of another one of those moments. It's like, okay, I'm ready to leap, but I'm scared to death of leaping because if something goes wrong or the chute doesn't deploy, you know, I'm just going to fall 250,000 feet to my death, you know, it's like, or metaphorically speaking, but, you know, at the same time, having that confidence of like, who says it has to go wrong? Who says it has to go bad? Who says it has to be bad? Who says, you know, growing has to be this terrible thing? Sure, there's going to be a lot of hindrances and bumps in the road, and there's going to be things in the way that you have to face and look at and analyze and all those thoughts you have to analyze. But it's one of those things, you know, and I applaud Kristen for her braveness to come on with us and, you know, despite everything that she's going through, to be able to come on here like the confident, young, beautiful woman she is and actually, you know, get her voice out there and say, hey, I'm having all this crap right now, but I'm going to speak to you anyway because I want to be here and this is what I really want to do. And I'm not going to listen
damn
to
right.
that. I'm not going to listen to the inner Adolf Hitler, you know, Deutschland, Uber allies. I'm not going to do that. I'm done with that. I'm going to be the young, patriotic, beautiful, rebellious woman that I am and stick a finger to that inner Nazi inside of me and, you know, do it anyway, because that's what I am and that's what I want to be. And, you know, so I applaud you, Kristen, because you're on the journey to that goal in which you want to reach. And we're all here to support you and help you in that endeavor. Just as Paul and Katerina and Dave are here to help me. We're all here to help each other. We're all here to be backing each other up. You know, we can all do this. You know, this is one of the most important times in human history. And, you know, it's a time in which we've entered the crossroads, and, you know, we can either decide to continue doing the same old thing and end up where we've always been and do what we've always gotten, or we can decide to do something revolutionary, do something different, and go on the path that we've decided to go on.
To that end, I think it would be very important for me to point out to Kristen that I have spent so much of my life feeling like everything I do and say is not good enough, that every time I type up a journal or I speak on a Google Hangout or whatever, there is that part of me that is terrified of all of it. Oh, what if I accidentally say this? What if I'm misunderstood as that? What if I don't say this right? What if I accidentally offend this person? Blah, 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 blah. All of the malware that goes through Kristen's head that sometimes she likes to think I don't have, I have it. And it's constantly running through me. And I'm just looking at it going like, okay, so what? I'm going to get up and speak anyway. Just like Kristen just said, okay, so what? I'm going to get up and speak anyway. And that's exactly what needs to be done. It's not about trying to avoid feeling terrified or avoid feeling shitty. It's just like, well, I feel like this, but fuck it. I'm just going to get up and speak anyway, and I'm going to say what needs to be said, because I am more sick of humanity being trapped in thousands of years of a cycle of neurosis, and that's not going to change if everybody just does the same old, same old. So fuck it. I'm just going to get up and talk, and people are going to think what they're going to think. And what I say, if it comes out right, comes out wrong, whatever, fuck it, whatever, you know, I'm done hiding. What's up?
I know we were going to let Paul speak because Paul wanted to speak, and we just kind of interjected on what he was going to add. And I think we ought to give him the floor and let him, let him say what he wants to say.
Well, how about this? Kristen, mute, Paul, speak. And then when Paul's done, Kristen, speak. And then Mel can add her thoughts on all this, because I'm sure she's got a lot to say.
All righty, guys. So, Kristen, when you were talking about how you prefer to write, how when you show up on text, it's actually something you're more comfortable with, I recognize this as a place that I've been in my personal journey, because I also used to really prefer text. In fact, I would write something down and then I would revise it 15 different times and take like 6 hours to communicate the most basic and simple thought, because I was so afraid that my first thought was wrong, that the first thing that came to my mind was wrong, that it was somehow not good enough. And now I'm realizing that I'm kind of going through, now I prefer video. And not only do I prefer video, I prefer unedited video, because I realized I was cock-blocking myself by being so intentional about, like, trying to edit myself. So now I'm just saying, hey, listen, who I am right now and what I have to say is good enough. I don't need to edit myself. I don't need to present my fourth draft to the world. I can present my first draft to the world, and people can love me or hate me, because they're gonna anyways. It doesn't matter. And the only difference is that now I'm saying a lot more things to the world, because I used to come out, I mean, I didn't even have a Facebook until like 3 years ago. I was just completely sequestered, completely cloistered in Costa Rica. And so I wanted to tell you, hey, this is a place in your journey. Like, I've been there before, and I'm telling you that it shows great healing when you are starting to be willing to just show up live and show up as you are, instead of showing up as you want the world to perceive you.
Like, it's you a did big today. Deal.
Just like you just did.
That was huge, Kristen. I've been on some of the Hangouts with you before, and like, I remember that you would hardly even speak.
Yeah. And so regarding your current situation, with essentially your father trying to blackmail you with a couple of $100 to become his religion. So imagine, if you will, that you go to a restaurant, and this restaurant has a huge menu, and you've been to this restaurant before, and you've tried a lot of the things, and you know, they were all, some of them were good, but they none of them were particularly life-affirming dishes at this restaurant. And this time you decide to try their hamburger, and you're like, so you try their hamburger and you eat their hamburger, and then you realize that this hamburger is the absolute best hamburger you've ever had. So what do you do now that you have this new information? Every time you go back to the restaurant, you eat the hamburger. and you tell your friends about the hamburger. And you say, hey, listen, I eat this hamburger, and this hamburger is actually life-affirming somehow. What you don't do is you don't go out and you don't beat your friends over the head and scream, you have to try this hamburger. You don't buy the hamburger for your friends and force it down their throat. Effective evangelism, which is what your father is trying to do, he's trying to evangelize, and he's really not doing a good job of it. But evangelism is simply saying, I found this thing, and it works for me, and this is the result in my life. Not, I found this thing, and it's the best thing for you. Not, I found this thing, and if you don't do it, then you're satanic, you're a heathen, you're wrong, you're bad, you're ugly, you're a terrible human being. But simply, I found this thing, and this is the result in my life, and I found that it brings my life benefit. And who knows, hey, if you want to try it, cool. If you look at my life and you say to yourself, I want to have a life like that person has, well, here's my secret. This is how I do it. And this has been a part of the journey that always confused me, because I was born and raised Christian, and I never really understood the mainstream Christianity. I never got it, because I was like, why on earth would you go out and tell all these people about Jesus when you clearly don't have a relationship with the guy? When there's absolutely no fruit in your life that shows me, like, your life is kind of terrible, and why would I want that? And over the course of time, as I've developed my own spirituality, I've come to understand that you're really just telling the people around you what's working for you, because you love them, because you care about them, because you love your neighbor as yourself, and consequently, when you see your neighbor going through something that you've gone through and that you have overcome, you simply give them the cheat sheet. And so what your father is doing of trying to make you be Catholic is so, it's such a fear paradigm. He's afraid that you're going to go to his definition of hell because you don't believe his definition of God. That's what that is. And
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You get a bird.
What's interesting about that? Okay, what's interesting about what you just said, Paul, yes, I totally agree with what you're saying. My dad is actually less interested about me going to hell. It's he feels that since I was baptized Catholic, he has a religious obligation to raise me to be Catholic. So it's actually self-centered. He's made that clear. He is the least Christian person I've known, which is the funniest thing. He's the least, like, just so bitter and so, and I'm just being honest, you know, I'm not even
hateful, spiteful, contemptful.
Very, very.
Nein, you must believe in the Catholic religion for the Reich. Heil.
Yeah. Well, he was raised super Catholic in the smallest town imaginable, so, you know, this is where this is coming from. But he has always had zero desire to really get to know me, and what he has gotten to know me scares him, which is why, you know, this money that he's holding on my head, $790, it was supposed to be graduation money my grandmother that, you know, I get when I graduate, and I've gotten honor roll every year of high school. I was supposed to get this money. Well, you know, then all of a sudden he starts saying, well, everyone else who got the graduation money from your grandmother had it got confirmed. So if you don't get confirmed, I'm not going to give you the remainder of this money. And so basically, sadly, my grandma didn't leave it to me. She left it to him in trust that he would give it to me. Blah, blah, blah. But I know.
He is legally in breach of trust.
Dave believes so. But technically, there is no document or anything that he has to give the money to me. So whether or not that's true, I am not willing to. You know, I was actually going through with the confirmation. This is the part I left out of the story. I was going to the classes with my brother, and it's a class eight. I'm a senior in high school right now. And I was getting the most out of it that I could. I do like some parts of the Bible. I think some of it's interesting. You know, I'm not going to throw out all the wisdom. But another thing that was really annoying about that class was it was at 9 a.m. every Sunday, and that was my only day to sleep in. And the class was with a bunch of eighth graders, and they were really loud. So the guy that was teaching the class could barely even get a word out edgewise. So I was thinking, well, maybe I could take adult classes, which would be during a weeknight, and there wouldn't be as many distractions. But that's what threw my dad off his rocker. Not even that I wasn't going to get confirmed, but
you gotta
that
I wasn't going to do it my way. If you find a better way.
Yeah, and I really mean, like, he was screaming in my face. about this, as loud as he screams ever. And I just, what I realized, and this is the biggest point that I wanted to really give from this, is that no amount of money is worth sacrificing myself or putting up with being screamed at, or, and then afterwards it got physical. Like, I told him I was going to leave, and he started shoving me back down onto the couch, and I'm 18 years old, I can leave if I want, and yanking on my arm, and that went on for like 2 minutes. It just hideous, and I left basically in a panic because it was totally horrifying. And so I'm like, you know, it's not worth the money. I'll get a job and pay for my own car insurance. I'll swallow the $790 and I'll make my own. And, you know, I don't need a relationship with someone that he doesn't care who I am anyways. It's not like it's even coming from a place of love. It's coming from a place of he feels like he has that obligation in the church. And, you know, he's the type of person who'll go to church every Sunday, but every other aspect of his life, there's no God to be seen. There's no God to be found.
He's what they call a pew sitter.
I personally don't think he ever intended to give you the money, that he was always going to find a reason to keep it. I think he wants you under his control, and he wants to keep the money. I don't think he was ever going to give it to you, in my opinion.
Yeah. You know, he said basically the same thing, but he said, well, she's not going to get confirmed anyway. She was just telling me that, blah, blah, blah. You know, like you said, who knows that he was going to give me the money. But basically, yeah, it's not worth sacrificing myself. And the biggest thing I've realized is that when it comes to feelings of low self-esteem, I've reached a point where once your self-esteem's so low, you have nothing to lose. So it's like I can share my thoughts. You know, I care more about – I'm more afraid of the world, you know, I'd rather just, since I have nothing to lose, why not put my voice out there if I feel like it's going to be scrutinized by everyone anyways? Why not put it out there, but the small chance that someone will hear it and someone will get something from it. If one person gets
totally.
One small thing from it, it was
worth it. I totally went through that too, Kristen. I mean, just recently, the whole thing I was going through with my sister, it just really highlighted for me that, like, fuck it. If I am going to be scrutinized, I might as well just, like, speak my truth, because that is the most important thing that is going on in my heart. I want to share my message. I want to share what is important to me. And
totally.
You know, if she doesn't like it, then whatever. Like,
I've told both Katerina and Kristen, because at one time or another, they've both been like, oh, I'm not going to succeed with making videos and this and that and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, I told both of them, you guys got to be willing to do it your way and stop trying to do it everyone else's way. Otherwise, you're right. You're not going to succeed if you don't do it your way. If you don't get up there and be authentic and do it your way, then you're right. You're not going to succeed. So you're only going to succeed when you decide that you're willing to be yourself and do things your way and stop trying to appease everybody else.
And come what may. That's really where I've gotten to. Come what may. And if people don't like what I have to say, like, I have, because of all of these paradigms that, you know, we're talking about right now, the malware, all of that stuff, learning how to deprogram that in yourself and to just recognize it and recognize the reflections and recognize the mirrors, I feel like a sense of freedom even when shit hits the fan, or like when something comes up and it's like, Dave loves to use that metaphor of like it's a error message on the computer screen and it's just like popping up. And that's how I'm seeing it now. Like, when somebody leaves a negative comment, or even when somebody doesn't like what I have to say and sends me a message and tells me how much they don't like something, it's just like,
talk about the negative comment you got on your
dance.
That
is so needed.
Yeah, but like, I got a negative comment on that dancing video of me, like, you know, one of me like doing
really?
The movement.
The hip dance.
Yeah. So somebody was like, "Oh, why did you post that?" And you know, in the past, that would have devastated.
Why would you watch?
Right, but in the past, that would have devastated me. And I would have been like, no, I'm not going to post anything more after that. But this time I was like, you know what? There will be people who think that that's gross because I offend their paradigms. And that's okay.
Oh, yeah.
I can
yeah.
Keep
yeah.
Me.
Even though everyone's shaking their hips in their own bedroom.
Katerina deleted that comment, and I was like, oh man, I was going to reply to them back with, you are so right, Katerina, why weren't you naked? Get naked now. Just to, like,
right.
Like,
not allowed.
That should be the only complaint.
And I have to interject here also. I'm sure that Mel would say that that Kristen is awake proper, which can only be properly said in a British accent. So we're all gonna mute now, and we're gonna get Melanie's take on everything we all just said.
Yes.
That's funny. Awake proper. I'm not actually British, just so you know, I'm South African. or as Dave said, my accent is well traveled. Sure, I'm listening to this all, and it's very interesting because I've experienced pretty much everything that every one of you is speaking about in different contexts to a larger or lesser degree. And the most relevant example of something I have to add to this is that obviously putting yourself out there and doing shows like this, you do actually make yourself pretty vulnerable and open to the public. And I'm not the type of person that's overly stagey. When I do present my information and research pieces, they are obviously more intentional. But I did start doing things more spontaneously and just being myself and talking honestly from my heart. And then I got a very nasty trolling channel who attached themselves to me. And these guys are vicious, okay? Like, I once made a comment about doing yoga, and they started making superimposed videos of me doing yoga and all sorts of things and teasing me. They saw a photo of my husband asleep at his desk, teasing me that, you know, my marriage is in trouble because my husband won't sleep next to me, and he actually just fallen asleep in his chair. And it was really, it got low and salacious. And they've accused my husband of being a pedophile. They've accused me of all sorts of things, crimes against humanity, doing the kind of work that I do. Just to give an example, as one of the things that I do, I've actually filed papers at the International Criminal Court for genocide in my home country, because I'm in fact a refugee in Holland. Doing the things that I do, obviously I attract a lot of support, but also detractors. And these are usually just people who are working through their own issues and want to project them at me. And this is what I always remember, is that most of these people, if they cannot see the beauty and the good in what I'm doing, okay, it's what they're doing is projecting their own inner ugliness because they themselves don't understand that space. They just don't understand. They don't understand what it's like to give your life for a cause, as I've done, to give up everything, all material possessions, to live with nothing to try and help humanity. You know, and when you get to a point really where you do not give a fuck what anybody else says, that is where you are at your freest. And starting with your parents, that's the first place you start. Because for me, that's where the most immediate control comes in your life. I've had to disentangle myself from a toxic family. I don't really need to go into the whole family bashing thing. I'm too respectful of the family despite what I've been through. But let's just say that they live in South Africa. I live here, and I saw them this year for the first time in 6 years. And even that was a very difficult thing. But that's, at the moment, that's like the smallest, they're the smallest monsters that I fight. And genuinely, with the work that we do, I'm so much more focused on, there is a huge, much bigger perspective out there, and there are much bigger monsters out there to fight. I sweat the small stuff. So when people say nasty things to you on Facebook, they troll you, they do this or that. That's more an externalization of their own inner ugliness and self-hatred and self-loathing than anything else. It's their projection. And you can absolutely, you can't decide how people act, but you can actually decide how their externalizations and projections affect you. And I quite simply do not let anyone affect me with their projections.
Hey, Mel, I think one of the biggest issues that people like to project on as well is they use their judgments of money to be hateful. And it's like, as well good and true as it is that the money system is a total fiat Ponzi system, we can still use that funny money to upgrade our house with solar and wind instead of buying it on McDonald's and the most expensive but otherwise worthless shoes and whatever else. And we can use that fake funny Ponzi money to empower ourselves and be an example that we don't have to be slaves to the system. And then if we would just refocus our spending on things that matter instead of buying all the things that society says we need to buy in order to be cool and whatever, that I think that we could take that tool of the elites and use it in an empowering way and set empowering examples. But instead, people think they have to like go abandon society and live off to themselves in the woods with no possessions in order to escape the evil Illuminati. But they don't understand that, you know, if they don't set empowering examples to help shift the masses, then, you know, those elites are going to knock on the back door of those woods, so to speak, soon enough. You know, they're going to leave no inch of the earth unaccounted for, and all they're doing is delaying their confrontation with the powers that be. They're not really avoiding that confrontation, so they put their judgments on money. One of my personal favorites is, like, you know, obviously I do YouTube videos and I make money through that. And sometimes people will be like, oh, you're just all in it for the money. I'm like, wait a minute. So if I'm giving you free videos to watch for free and I'm making money by default of doing that instead of entering into the enslavement system of our enemy and working for the enemy and empowering our enemy and spending 9+ hours, you know, a day for 5+ days a week being a total cog in the wheel for the system, because I'm making my money being free and promoting freedom and empowerment, somehow that must mean I'm all out for the money and nothing else. Like, really? What are you guys smoking? Anything you want to say to that, Melanie?
Yes. You know, the money paradigm is a difficult one, because yeah, it's a fiat monetary system, it's the root of all evil, but I also believe it is an energy, and we can actually decide how we use that energy for destruction or creation again. And I get a lot of that as well around Conscious Consumer Network. It's a non-profit humanitarian project. Everything we make goes straight back into running this project. But even to get it to the point of doing that, I took a lot of criticism from people about the fact, oh yeah, you're doing this for the money. I'm like, do you want to come see where I live? Do you want to come see where how the studio is set up, how humble it is, the fact that I sold my car to keep the project afloat, the fact that I, you know, have sacrificed so much for everything that I've done and put out huge amounts, even books, my previous works, put them out for free, because my book, The South African Guide to the Global Conspiracy, was banned in South Africa, and the only way I could get it out was to have it put out for free as an ebook so that people can access it online. It was never about making money. It was actually about empowering and reaching people, and that's what it's always been. Simple fact is, the studio has a rental price attached to it, just like we have to pay for internet, just like we still do have to pay for electricity and all the amenities. So you want to say to me, like, I'm in it for the money. My lifestyle doesn't exhibit that, not in the slightest. If anybody wants to spend some time with me, they're welcome to do so. My books and the way we run our network are very open and very transparent. We publish everything. We do this as from as ethical a place as we could. And if I could do it without having monetary restraints or monetary limitations, trust me, I would be. And people say, oh yeah, well, you know, if you got a whole bunch of money tomorrow, you drop all this humanitarian work. The honest truth is, my life wouldn't change. I just have more resources to kick more ass with and do it in a good way.
We really have experienced a lot of that. I mean, when we were in Costa Rica, we spent time with a lot of missionaries, and we spent time helping with their projects down there. You know, the sex trafficking is a big issue in Costa Rica, and there is a lot of young girls who are starting, who are basically prostituted into this sex slavery. And we were down there, but we had noticed that there was a lot of people who, they were missionaries and they were doing God's work and they were doing the good things in the world, and but they were struggling really hard. And I just think it's such an interesting paradigm to address, because when we talk about you know, people spreading this message and spreading truth and doing that kind of work in the world, like there is this unconscious idea that somehow they don't deserve to prosper or benefit from that, even though they're doing really, really amazing things, and God's servants need to be cared for, you know? So that's been a journey Paul and I have been taking. It's, mm-hmm. it's really caused us to start the Money, Power, Sex project, because, you know, both of us,
YouTube channel.
We've been the people who have been like living in the jungle with like crap internet and really broken shit and stuff that doesn't work in our lives. And it was impeding us from being able to be fully mm-hmm. all that we can be, you know, it was stopping us from fulfilling our greater potentials, you know, of being able to reach more people.
Yeah. And we just got this synchronicity. So my email just popped up and it said one new email from Journey of Riches. Never heard of this ever before.
That's really funny.
But the real riches, though, is when the money does not control you, when you can just wield it as the spiritual resource in your mm-hmm. life and see that it doesn't control you anymore, because you're not of this world. You really are connected to your spiritual roots and in your love for humanity and your love for what you're doing. And that no longer is it a temptation for it to come in right. and usurp your life and become mm-hmm. your God anymore. You know, that's why Solomon was able to like be added, have money added back to him. You know, he became wise, and then he wielded it as a big tool in the world.
You know what? I think that Diana Hamilton and Bob Meyer are on the journey of witches as opposed to the journey of riches.
the only real rich you need is right here.
Yeah. There you go.
Had to make the joke.
Yeah, something relating to horses. But anyway, that's an inside joke. I won't go there.
That's an inside joke. Like, that's like the inside joke, like I was mentioning with William Black. That's another discussion.
Yeah, those who know, and those who don't know. But anyway, yeah, I mean, totally. And just like, I think that people who get wealthy have a responsibility to be the change that they want to create. And instead of taking tons of money and investing in all of these, well, for lack of a better way of saying it, Illuminati, Satanic-run charities that pretend to be positive, they need to be the change themselves and really have their own projects and their own initiatives and be willing to do the work instead of writing a check and just say, okay, I did my good deed for the day. Now I can sit here and be a scumbag and apathetic and not have to do anything. I think rich people have a responsibility to be themselves and to be the change and to put that forth instead of scapegoating it and writing it off like, okay, I wrote my check, so now I can give my middle finger to the world.
I have some real personal family experience with that. I don't think Mel knows this, but maybe I did say it on the last conversation. I can't remember.
Your grandparents in Africa, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, you did.
Okay, I did mention that. But anyway, yeah, I've said it before. I'll say it for other people who are joining this conversation via YouTube who don't know. I'll just go into the backstory. My grandparents spent 30 to 35 years in Africa, East Africa, over in Kenya, out in the Rift Valley, helping people out in the Pokot tribe region. My dad spent 8 years over there. He had a very traumatic experience in a Kenyan prison. He spent a couple of nights.
Kitty cat.
Okay, that was random.
He spent, well, Melanie's got her kitty cat. I just noticed.
Oh, okay. But my dad spent 2 nights in an African jail cell, and my middle name, Lyle, Richard Lyle Scott Hamilton, Lyle was a family friend of my grandparents. His name was Lyle Hudson, and he had a heart attack while he was in prison, really bad. He'd always had a weak heart. He had a very big kind of open heart. He had a lot of heart issues. And well, the events that happened those couple of nights were just too much for him. And he was having a coronary. So there was like this kind of beat up, nasty looking mattress that the prisoners moved out of the way to allow him to sit on, because he was having chest pains and my dad and a bunch of the other prisoners that were in the cell had to stand. They literally had to stand because the toilet that was right across the way was overflowing and broken, and it was just flowing right into the cell. I mean, it was literally a third world prison. And yeah. My dad still deals with, my dad doesn't claim that he thinks about that stuff, but something like that, I mean, that's PTSD inducing, you know, that's some real fucked up damage. I mean, you can't just forget, you know, something that's that traumatic and that nasty, no matter how much mm-hmm. you claim that you try. I mean, he denies that he's got, you know, he denies that he's still got issues and that he's gotten over it. But I'm like, there's no way you can get over something like that. That, I mean, even when you get to the point where you can deal with it efficiently and effectively, that will still haunt you for the rest of your life. Yeah. Because it's one of those events that it's like, you saw somebody that you knew, that you loved, that you cared about, and they were dying in front of you. You couldn't do anything to help them. But anyway, they got released from prison, and, you know, there were some papers at the Kenny police station, and this was the national paper, and my dad looked at the Lyle looked at the headline, and, you know, it said missionaries caught in coup to overthrow government. Details on page 3A or whatever, and Lyle went, "Oh my God!" And he just went, and he just fell right over, and he died right there. It just that was the final blow. It killed him. And he, you know, my dad ran to the hospital to try to get help, and when he came back, he was being pulled out of the police station. He had a toe tag on, so, you know. Going to governmental corruption, my grandparents have dealt with that for 30 plus years. And it's a very alive and well thing over in Africa. I mean, it's, you know, there have been a lot of crimes that have happened over there, not only to missionaries, but to, you know, native colonial inhabitants who have lived there like yourself, Mel. I mean, you know, the Rhodesians, you know, I mean, the African governments are about as corrupt as any can possibly get. And Kenya is nice, relatively nice compared to a lot of the other governments. There were a lot of governments that just told all the white folks to pack their shit up and leave, and if you stay around, we're going to shoot you, you know. I mean, that was the attitude. You know, and that's why Africa's gone from, you know, an export, you know, a country that exports food to other parts of the world to a country where they can barely even feed their own citizens and they have to import food. It's been, you know, Africa is an example of globalist agenda 21 total fuckover. I mean, you know, and Africa's a beautiful continent. I mean, it's an absolutely amazing place. There's all this natural beauty. The wildlife there is, you know, unique to any place in the world. You know, Africa is one of the most unique and beautiful continents probably anywhere on the planet, you know, just in terms of biological and, you know, terrain diversity. You can go from desert to jungle and back to desert again. I mean, it's an amazing continent. And, you know, the cultures and the history that's on that continent is equally fascinating, equally interesting, and equally amazing in and of itself. But, you know, just to point that out, I mean, you know, I totally sympathize with that because I've heard the stories, you know, of what they do over there. And a lot of people, you know, if you tell some uninformed person on the street what goes on over there, they would never believe you because it doesn't seem that real. It doesn't seem like it can get that crazy, but it does. My grandparents, in fact, were, yeah, multiple times there were these two rivaling tribes, the Karamongjong and the Pokot. They've been enemies for probably about 1,000 years. I mean, this is going clear back to before, you know, this is probably going back to the medieval ages at least. And, you know, Idi Amin, who was the head dictator in Uganda, just right next door, you know, another failed country that kicked, you know, kicked all of the infrastructure right out and it just went into the toilet just right after it. You know, after he was deposed from power and, you know, they did all of the Israelis did the raids on Entebbe and stuff like that. You know, my grandparents were actually going to go on a flight into Entebbe, and that was just right before the Israelis carried out the airstrikes and they ended up. No, wait a minute. Entebbe was Libya, I think. I think Entebbe was Libya. My mind's trying to do five things at once. I'll have to look that up later. But anyway, going back to the tribe story, Idi Amin fell, and there were a bunch of armories that were along the border. Well, the Karamongjong, they got to those armories first, and they were able to acquire a bunch of Soviet AK-47s and RPGs and machine guns and all kinds of stuff. I mean, they had this armory that had, like, you know, it was an entire warehouse just full of rifles and ammunition. I mean, you know, probably a billion rounds of ammunition and all the rifles you could have, you could arm an entire army with it, you know, and they got to it first. Well, this was right around the time my grandparents were getting in with World Vision, you know, one of those big Christian organizations, you know, that just hands money out. I mean, without them, they wouldn't have been able to do it at the time, but even still, it's one of those kind of organizations that's there, but, you know, they don't really do all of the hard work like some people out in the field do. You know, my grandparents did stuff over there that a majority of missionaries who were there weren't willing to do. They went out into the areas where none of the other missionaries wanted to go. Most of the missionaries just stayed up in the high mountains where it was cool and it was raining all the time and water was abundant and everywhere. My grandparents said to these people on multiple occasions, it's like, what are you people doing? You guys claim to be spreading the word of God, but you're spreading it to people who have already heard the message. You're stagnant. You're not doing anybody any favors up here. You know, there'd be like five churches within a mile of each other, and they, you know, one's Catholic, one's, you know, there's like five different sects of Christianity all within the same area up in the highlands, and you go down the Rift Valley about, you know, 50 or 60 miles, and there's not, you know, there isn't civilization, there's no running water because it's desert, and there's a bunch of these people out there that have never seen a white person, much less heard anything that's westernized or heard, you know, heard that there's a benevolent God that loves them, that cares about them, that wants the best for them, that wants them to thrive, that wants them to grow, that doesn't hate them, that doesn't want them to burn in the pit of hell, you know, because they didn't worship the sacred sun god seven times a day and slaughter the sacrificial cow. You know, that's not the kind of gods we deal with. God is not that way. God, you know, we make all these man-made rules and regulations on a benevolent, loving God that's created us in his image, created this universe. But anyway, going back, besides that side story, going back,
we're dysfunctional, so we assume God must also be, because we anthropomorphize onto God.
Yeah. But going back into the main story, you know, my grandparents were down there dealing with tribes that had never seen fully automatic weapons. Here they are for the first time using these guns. They're treating them like bows and arrows in terms of range. So they get like within 40 yards of each other, and then they're going boom, 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 you know. And they were in the middle of these kinds of gunfights, you know. My grandmother had to protect a bunch of kids during one of those cattle raids. You know, these Karamongjong had come along with the AKs and used them as bow and arrows, you know. I mean, they're guns, you know, they know how to use them and shoot them properly, but they treat them with the same range as a bow. And, you know, here's the Pokot, you know, they're just armed with nothing more than spears and shields. And, you know, I mean, I wish I could show you the footage, but my grandfather was carrying this warrior. He was completely frail, and he was bleeding a lot, and he had bullet wounds and stuff, and he's carrying him in his arms, and he's just laying there, and he carries him to the back of a van and puts him in the back and stuff, and is screaming for one of the nurses to come help him, because, I mean, these people were literally on the edge of civilization. They had no concept of anything other than just sheer survival. You know, it's the dry season. The only thing that means survival is having enough cattle to drain for their blood and mixing it in the curdled milk. That's all they knew. All they knew was to how to barely survive. They didn't know any other context of, oh, we can actually thrive. We can grow crops. We can drill wells. We can, you know, we can irrigate these crops. We can grow things. You know, there's this benevolent God that wants us to thrive, that wants us to expand, that wants us to have all of these wonderful things that God created for us. You know, they had no concept of that. And, you know, my grandparents did a lot of that hard work that a lot of these other missionaries, you know, they're sitting up there in the highlands drinking iced tea and, you know, acting all high and mighty. Oh, look at us. Yes, we're missionaries. Oh, we're doing such wonderful work. When really all they're doing is just doing something that their parents, their grandparents, and their great grandparents started all of those generations ago, but are they interested in going out into the highlands or into the lowlands down there in the Rift Valley and actually spreading the message and going up into the hills of Mount Kadam and doing all that? No, no, because that would be too hard. That would be dangerous. That would be scary. You know, you could put your life on the line, you know? So to get back to the main point, you know,
God forbid our faith be tested. Ooh, too much.
Yeah. You know, just to get to the main point, I have heard the stories. I've witnessed that stuff in the missionary world. And, you know, there's people who make a difference and go out and sacrifice, like my grandparents did. You know, even though they've got a lot of dysfunctional paradigms, and there's a lot of things I could say about them that are totally dysfunctional. But even still, there's a difference. You know, there's people who go out and do it. And get the and do what needs done, and then there's people who, you know, are stagnant, you know, and I'm not, and I don't come from a stagnant family. I'm not a stagnant person, and you know,
difference and, between knowing the path and walking the path, and those people up in the highlands did not want to walk the path.
No, they're too busy, you know, being a pew sitting pastor, you know. Oh, we're doing the holy righteous work of God. Yes, all, you know. Look at us up here in the highlands where everything's good and the rain, and it's 70 degrees all the time. And, you know, go down to the Rift Valley, it'd be like 130 degrees in some areas, and it's just smoking hot and it's no fun, you know, living in a dung packed mud hut, you know, that's got a tin roof and some hay over it, you know. That was what
doing the work of stroking their own arrogance.
Yeah, they're doing the work of stroking their own arrogance while people like my grandparents went out into the field and actually did some stuff, you know. So, yeah, I totally get, you know, that whole paradigm within the missionary field. It's totally dysfunctional.
Yeah, totally. Kristen, anything else you want to add about things? I know you've been patiently listening.
Not really, other than just that, what it really, like I said before, it comes down to, yeah, that fuck it point. And I know you guys all added what you thought about that. And that really helps, because it kind of makes, it doesn't make all of the victimization paradigms invalid, but it makes them not matter when it comes to helping others and helping yourself. It's like you have nothing to lose. And also,
and you can't help others if you're not willing to help yourself. It's all one.
Yeah, and that ties into me with what Rich is saying about doing the work. You know, once you reach that fuck it point, you can only talk so much about it and, you know, intellectualize so much. There comes a point where action has to happen, and, you know, that could be action within your own life or it could be missionary work, but once you reach that fuck it point and all these illusions drop and become like they don't matter, you have to actually start doing stuff. We don't have to, obviously, free will, but it does create a lot of cognitive dissonance for me, I've noticed. If I'm not actively working on my goals or changing my habits that I know are dysfunctional and disempowering, it does feel different than what it did before. It's less likely to create a sense of escape for me, and it's more like it adds on to feelings of victimization, because I know what I'm doing is not helping me, and there's no way around that anymore. So it's all about, even though you feel like shit, go out and do. Just be it and be in the moment. And that's really hard, but it's so freeing to just be in the moment and do it 1 second at a time with your full focus in.
Like Jesus said, you got to help yourself before you can help others. You can't take the speck out of your brother's eye with this big ass plank sticking out of your head. It doesn't really work too well. Mm-hmm. Or as I like to say, if you want to share your plate of cookies, you have to have a plate of cookies to begin with.
Well, yeah. And what can be so upsetting about that is some people know that what they want to do is help others. And then they go into it. And when they are not effective at helping others, I know this has been me, or helping their friends even, it can be such a letdown. They don't understand what they're doing wrong, or they just literally don't have the energy to handle other people. So knowing that there's something that you have to address in yourself, usually a lot to address in yourself before you can be that rock for others or have clarity to even give to others.
If you can't keep your own company, you're not going to be able to keep anybody else's.
Yeah. I think that's a big reason I've been antisocial lately. It's because I know if I'm going to go out, I'm going to probably bring others down with me a bit. And some people are okay with that. Some people I know aren't. And yeah, but see, that's kind of a double-edged sword, because in some ways, staying alone is helpful when I'm ready to tackle my shit. But if I'm not, it's victimization for me, because I'm like, I'm alone and there's no one that understands. And there's
well, you also know that
I can go
no
to.
No matter how you're feeling at whatever time, you know that we're here for you. You can talk to me anytime. You can talk to Richard anytime. You can talk to Katerina and Paul anytime. We are here for you, and our doors are forever open.
Yeah, and I have been taking advantage of that more often. Not always through voice mode, but usually with text. I've been letting myself kind of talk to a friend in just a little bit. That does help.
It totally does.
Sometimes. Yeah, even just a text, mm-hmm. a few texts to a friend does help when you're sitting there alone.
I know that you've definitely been there for me in moments where I really needed it, so yeah, I agree.
Me?
And we're also, yeah, you.
Dave.
And we're
aww.
And
yeah.
And we're also very grateful that you decided to come on here with us and speak everything that you spoke, and we hope that you realize that that's what needs to be done. You're not doing anything the wrong way or bad. You don't look stupid. You don't look incapable, nothing like that. You're just up here being honest, and that's exactly what the world needs right now. People brave enough to be up here and be honest, you know, and we are very
well,
thankful.
You guys are equally as brave.
We're very thankful that you've decided to, and we hope that you decide to more and more often, and we hope you realize that you are worthy and deserving of getting up here with us and talking with us, and that you don't have to hide in a hole of unworthiness.
Yeah, well, I might not always feel that strongly, but I do know that I hate the system that makes people feel like they aren't more than I am willing to keep buying into it. I hate that more than I hate myself, and that's when I realized I can start doing it.
Yeah. That's a good starting point. I think that's been all of our starting points. That's been Melanie's
yeah.
starting point, Richard's starting yeah. point, my starting point, Paul and Katerina.
Oh,
that's
totally.
Been all
totally.
Of our starting point. This is the starting point right here. That
yep.
that is the starting point.
Let's
I've
all
always
give
loved
it.
The middle finger.
Where did Richard go?
I don't know.
He's got chair abundance. He had abundant shock for his chair. He's like, this is so comfortable. I need to go sit on something hard.
Yeah, or maybe his bladder had an overabundance and it needed to be shared with the toilet. I don't know. Melanie, your continued thoughts on all of this.
Oh, I'm just listening to you guys. It's truly a lovely group of people. And it's I love listening to people's stories. As a journalist, I think that's a good skill, is to enjoy listening more than you enjoy speaking. And it's been really wonderful to get an insight into all of your lives. And I've experienced so much of what all of you have experienced in different contexts. But I do want to speak to something that Richard said earlier, because he brought up a very interesting point about the missionaries, and that, you know, there's those ones who sit on the top of the mountain drinking tea. Oh, aren't we good little missionaries? Look at us in Africa, who do absolutely fuck all to make a difference. And, you know, you get a variation of that now in the so-called awaken aware or truth movement, where you've got these, what I call people, you know, physical, commercial and materialism is no longer cool. Now it's intellectual materialism. And oh my goodness, you've got these intellectual materialists who sit in their ivory towers and, you know, they run various sort of humanitarian projects whilst flying around the world to conferences and speaking events, but doing very little other than doing very little to create a difference for everybody. And really all they're doing is building their own platform, building their own celebrity, building their own social equity. And when you look at their projects, this is as a project manager, it's one thing I'm very good at. And I do a lot of these global initiative reviews on Conscious Consumer Network. It's not made me very popular because I'm pretty brutal when I dissect people's projects and I look at how the funding's being spent and all that kind of thing, because I am interested in projects that are going to work. So I'm going to look at your project and go, okay, let's look at the viability, let's look at the proposal, let's look at the budget that you're asking for fundraising for. Is that enough money for what you're proposing? Are you proposing something that's unrealistic for what you're asking, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? Run it through a set of parameters and that I would do for any project that I took on. And to be honest with you, 90% of the sort of so-called humanitarian, Awaken Aware, Freedom Projects, you know, things like New Earth Nations, Swiss Indo, there's a whole bunch of them that's going on out there at the moment. They're pure distraction. You've got key figures at the center of this that are literally energetically looshing off volunteers and people who are dedicating these lives to these causes and then waking up and realizing that they've been dedicating their lives to absolute rubbish because these causes aren't going anywhere. These are the people who get despondent and who then drop out the truth movement or don't want to do anything or become apathetic. And just, and it hurts me when I see that, because there's so many good people out there who are sick of the way things are, who want to make a change, who have real talent and capability, but they get sucked up into these sort of fake, oh, let's change the world, you know, bullshit projects that don't do anything. Okay, whilst these people at the center of them are flying around the world and being big celebrities, oh, look how great I am, I'm me and my project, which isn't really doing anything. You know, and then the volunteers all get despondent. And I've got troops and troops and troops of people who've written to me over the years, some of them volunteer on my projects, that are what I call rejects of other projects, or people who have called out on other projects that haven't met what was supposed to be done. And there's so much of it going on at the moment that just everybody is despondent. It is so hard to get people now volunteering for good projects because you've got a lot of people literally screwing people over left, right, and center, and big, big names as well. The Ubuntu Project, New Earth Nation. I've called these guys out. I've presented the evidence. So this is nothing new. When I say to you, there's major problems there, and it's putting a lot of people off getting involved in these sort of things. And to me, I think that's kind of deliberate. I think it's part of what they're trying to do, because they don't really want people, oh yeah, we've got some power, we've got some motivation, we've got some ability, let's go get involved and do something. What they want to do is not have us collaborating. They want us fighting, they want us separated, they want us divided. That's what they want.
Yeah, World Citizen Project, Santos Bonacci, and all this other stuff. I know Santos had a nervous breakdown recently. He went all like flat earther and when anyone else could just completely nuts. And then there's the World Citizen Project that they got all this money. And then it's like, oh, well, actually, we can't do exactly what we thought we were going to do. So we're going to do this another way. Oh, really? What other way? Where's the money going? Oh, well, we're not talking about that right now. What do you mean we're not talking about that right now? You're getting all this money. Where's it going? Well, we're doing good stuff. Well, what good stuff? Well, we're going to, you know, yes. And it's like, wait a minute, red flag, red flag, red flag.
Damn right. You know, this is I actually called the World Citizenship Project when it was first launched, because having worked in a number of these initiatives, I looked at the amount of money they were wanting to raise and what they proposed to do with it, and I was going, that's not enough money to do what they're proposing. It's not. And I was saying upfront, this project's not going to go anywhere. And when they'd raised all that money, I was like, well, now you've realized you don't have the money to do what you want to do. You're going to need a hell of a lot more resources. So what are you going to do with the money you have? Oh, no, it's going to go and buy, what's it do with the tear on his face, a tattooed tear? I forget his name. Ken O'Keefe. Yeah, Ken O'Keefe took the money and went and bought himself a property down in Costa Rica with all that money. That's what he did. Thank you. Thank you to everyone who donated to the World Citizenship Program. You're now funding Ken O'Keefe's property down in Costa Rica. That's what happened to the money. And it's the same with Sasha Stone and New Earth Nation. Okay, Sasha Stone is supposedly starting a whole New Earth Nation type thing, and all the volunteers and all the money, guess what happened? It went into enlarging his own personal property in Bali, which he claims is New Earth Havens, which is $120 a night retreat for very wealthy hippies. Because trust me, in Bali, you can get a five-star hotel for $50 a night, okay, in parts of Indonesia. $120 to come stay at Sasha Stone's New Earth Haven, just to stay in one of his ergonomically designed little pod huts on his barley property that he's used donations and labor from volunteers to build. How does that benefit humanity? How does another holiday resort benefit humanity? It doesn't, okay? It doesn't. So, you know, I'm getting really sick of it because, unfortunately, my network has given a platform to a number of these projects. Obviously, I'm very optimistic. I'm always wanting to work with people who seem to be talking the right talk and claiming to have good intentions and wanting to work towards creating a better world. But the more you work with these people, the more you realize they lack that key ingredient we spoke about before, compassion. And that is why they are fake. It's because if you don't have compassion, you're not awake and you're not working from the right space. If you're not compassionate, you're a psychopath or you're a sociopath, then you're only totally self-centered and solipsistic, and you can't claim to be doing anything for the benefit of anyone else but yourself. So, yeah. Very frustrating. We've supported a number of these projects. It's it's been very difficult, obviously, when we realize we've got to call them out to then step back and back out and go, well, without causing too much damage in the online stratosphere, but saying, hang on a second, there's stuff wrong here, you know? And people lash out at us and we're the big baddies for pointing out the perils. But the honest truth is that the moment I know that something's wrong, I simply cannot back these projects anymore. And,
one thing I point out that creates a lot of cognitive dissonance in people because of their whole, misery and difficulty paradigms. I say, look, you don't need all these projects, this, that, and the other. There's a zillion different small things that the average individual can do that, if done en masse, can make a big difference. It doesn't require signing up to any clubs or donating any money or doing all these different projects. There's like a zillion different simple little freaking things that if everybody did en masse that most people are fully capable of doing, very simple little things. I mean, I could probably create a whole long, big list of just simple little tiny things that if enough people were doing it en masse, it would change the world. And people are like, oh no, that's too easy, that's too simplistic, that couldn't possibly be real, and da 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 da. And it's like, that's where their belief systems are.
Yes, absolutely. And this is the basis upon which you build Conscious Consumer Network. People go, oh, why do you use the word consumer in your, because it is the consumer I'm trying to reach. Everything we do, we consume. When we breathe, we consume air. When we eat, we consume food. The power lies in doing it consciously. Be conscious about the information you take in. Be conscious about the words you put out. Be conscious about what you project, because your words are spells. Be conscious about, your shopping habits, supporting small family businesses as opposed to conglomerates. That's one of the things I do. Taking your own reusable carrier bag so you don't add to the plastic problems. All those kind of things you could do, small little things to make a difference every day. Recycling, as you said, there's a million things you can do. And that is the message we preach with Conscious Consumer Network. Really, it's about everybody taking responsibility as a consumer, because that is where the changes are made.
Yeah, people always say, oh, but I'm not in a position to do this or do that or do the other. And I'm like, fine, don't do this, that, and the other. Do what you can do. What can you do? What is within your means? Oh, I don't want to think about that because I'm too busy sitting here self-loathing, going, I'm not good enough. I can't do anything. And da-da-da. It's like, no, there's plenty of things you can do. Just calm down and think, what little simple things can you do that, if done en masse, can make a difference? It's like, oh, well, what if I'm the only one doing it? Then what kind of difference is that going to make? Da-da-da-da-da. It's like, well, yeah, if everybody's talking exactly the way you're talking and doing nothing, then everybody always says, oh well, if that was going to work, then everybody would be doing it. Or like, oh well, I wish someone would do that. And it's like, well, you're someone. If you're wishing somebody would go do that, then go do that.
It's total Agenda 21 psyop, because I mean, the globalists have been so good at it over the last 200 plus years of perpetuating this mass brainwashing. They brainwash people into, like, oh, you want to be the change, do you? Here, give some money to the babysitter and we'll do it for you, there, pilgrim. It's kind of that attitude. It's like, and everybody falls for it. They're like, oh, yes, babysitter, do it for me. Here's all my money. Here's my bank account. Here's my deed to my house. Here's my soul, do it for me.
Oh, it's even worse than that.
The moment you offer to have somebody independently be the change that they want to create. Like some of these small organizations, like the one that my grandparents still do the publicity for, it's called the East Africa Christian Mission. They, you know, all of that money, they make sure that that goes to, you know, what it's going to go to. It goes out to the field. It goes out to all the pastors who are out there. It helps them do what they need to do. It helps them cover basic living expenses. It helps them, you know, money goes out to those wells. Money, you know, they make sure that that money, you know, because let's face it, the world is right now run by money. You know, you've got to still be able to feed yourself. You've still got to be able to wipe your butt. You've still got to be able to have sustenance in your house. You still got to be able to have money for food and all of that stuff. You know, you've still got to be able to have the basic necessities to survive. But yeah, a lot of these organizations, like especially churches, there's like this whole sacrificial thing around the tithing. You know, they almost, a lot of these mainstream churches, I noticed even back in the days when I was considered a pew sitter, you know, they guilt trip you into doing it. Like, oh, if you don't do it, God looks down on you and he hates you. And he's going to throw you in the pit of hell because you didn't tithe for the church. You sick, disgusting animal. You selfish, loathing. It's all your fault. It's all, you know, that's the attitude they have, that, you know, that self-perpetuated, arrogant narcissism that if you don't put a check for $500 into our little cloth lined bag or onto the plate, you're a sick, disgusting sinner. Why we ought to throw you into the holy fire, by God. You know, you can hear the moronic preacher on TV, you know, do that anytime if you want, but I would prefer not.
But one of the more interesting things too is that the globalists want us to blame them for everything, because then we have an attitude of, well, they're so big and bad, we shouldn't bother doing anything good because they've won anyway. It's all their fault. They're too powerful. I'm like, wait a minute. Where do you think they get their power? You think they have it? No. We give it to them through our complacency. We look at them and go, oh, they're way too powerful. Why should we bother? And that is where they get their power from.
And see, the thing is, if every person on the planet, you know, was in the business of, or if most people, majority of people, like 75% of people were in the business of genuinely helping each other, like legitimately helping each other and legitimately doing things to not only empower themselves, but to empower all those people around them, you know, throwing the metaphorical stone into the pond and creating a splash, like I was talking about. If everybody was in that business themselves, doing their own genuine thing, being themselves, doing what they want to do, and I'm not saying everybody, but a majority of people were in that business of genuinely doing what they wanted to do and creating the change that they wanted to create within themselves and within their sphere of immediate influence that they could physically see,
the world would change almost overnight.
Do you think the globalist power structure would be able to survive that? No.
Nope.
The only mm-hmm. way they maintain their systems or illusions of control is by keeping humanity in the psychological perpetuation of fear, ignorance, and stupidity, and keep the masses easily distracted with easily attainable things such as giving money to these giant babysitter churches or these babysitter organizations that do absolutely nothing but coddle the masses just to make them feel better about themselves. And, you know, yes, please be sure to donate to the pastoral trip to Ecuador fund.
Give
your money to the Joel Osteen private airplane fund. We need to raise about $30 million for that that private Gulfstream. Well, what are you going to do with that Gulfstream, Mr. Osteen? We're going to fly down to Africa, and we're going to help those people down there with it. Well, how are you going to help people with the airplane, Mr. Osteen? You know, that gold trim bathroom, you know, that'll be a place where I can do my holy thinking and really, really help those people to do the outreach I need to do. Yeah, that's it. You know, I mean, this is the literal buffoonery that exists in the modern church as we know it today.
Yeah, it's pretty fucked.
People buy it. You know, and then there's all this infighting within the church. I'm not big on infighting. And I'm ranting, I know, but this is one thing that you know, I've heard so much about, and it's like so relevant to this conversation, but you know, there's so much infighting within the church and within these major organizations. Everybody's pointing fingers at each other and, you know, looking at each other all, suspiciously. Oh, what are those people doing over there? What are those people doing over there? My grandparents dealt with so much of that in Africa. You know, they would have missionaries talk crap behind their backs, you know, and my grandparents would do it about them. You know, oh, what are those people over there doing? Why are they getting in on our organization? Who do they think they are? You know, oh, they're trying to outstage us. Oh, well, you know, and it just becomes this major dickwag contest with all of these different outreach organizations. And then before you know it, you've got this whole clusterfuck of chaos because nobody's interested in actually doing anything that helps. They're interested in trying to outdo each other. It's like, oh, those people over there, they built that. Well, we better do like that five times grander because oh, they're evil and oh man, they can't do that. We got to be in control of it all because we got to micromanage because our egos are the size of Alaska and you know we've got to control the mission field and
you know, by their egos you shall know them. Their egos, you shall know them.
It's one of those things. It's like, you know, I've heard the stories. I look at my grandparents and I'm thinking to myself, in some ways, you guys are no better. Look at yourselves before you, you know, remove the plank out of your eye before you start criticizing your brother for the speck in his, you know? It's the same type of crap. Not discounting what my grandparents have done. They've done a lot of great things and they've done a lot of good stuff over there, but, you know. They've adopted a lot of those same attitudes and paranoias and superstitions. And, you know, if missionaries would drop the crap and go, okay, we're all in this together. We're all interested in helping. That's the main goal of why we're here. These countries would literally turn around overnight because there would be this unified, like, let's help people. I don't care what your message is. I don't care what my message is we are in the goal of helping people. We want to change people's lives. We want to do the right thing and we want to help people to better themselves. That's the main goal, you know?
And to that end, the funny thing is the conspiracy theorists don't realize they're the biggest asset of the elites because these conspiracy theorists aren't just putting out information. I'm not knocking their information. It's all well and valid. Like 95% of it's true, but they do it from a platform of fear. Oh, look at all this. The elites are too big. We have no chance. They're these big monsters. We're these tiny little bugs. Whatever could we possibly do against this big menacing force? And they haven't put it together yet that, wait a minute, our complacency is the power that this big menacing force is using. And if we would knock off the fear, they wouldn't be a big menacing force anymore. If we could knock out all the infighting and all the fear porn. And a lot of people think that spreading a negative message or negative data, quote unquote, is fear porn. No, that's not fear porn. People's reaction to it is fear porn. Oh my God, shut up about Agenda 21. That's fear porn. You're making me panic. I'm triggered. No, that reaction, that is fear porn. The information itself isn't fear porn. That fucking reaction is the fear porn.
Okay, I just want to interject with something right there. It's, I think that's what's so interesting because a lot of what's going on in these power and control dynamics, especially in America, they aren't super obvious. It's very easy to get caught into a place of that complacency and that ignorance. I mean, you can get caught up in the stream world, and that's a lot of what my family's in, you know, kind of buying into the system. It's until that the reality of it will come and slap people in the face that things really aren't fair and they aren't going well. And it's because the system in at its core is meant for that. And that's way harder when you're caught in that place of ignorance and where, you know, there's an illusion of freedom. And then once you realize that, once the responsibility is on you because your complacency is what's letting it happen, it is such a trigger. It's such a slap in the face, and it brings up everything.
The realization
feels like you can't rise up out of it.
The realization that the system isn't broken. We've been lied to about what the system is there to do. The system's working fine. The system's there to screw us.
Yeah, and so it's hard for all of us when what we've been told our whole lives is a lie, and then once you know it's a lie, thinking what can you do to help it change it. But yeah, it's once you just like you said, everything that we do is either conscious or not conscious. You do what you can with every little bit, and that's the only way the progress will be made.
There's also the old saying that people would rather hear a blissful lie than a harsh truth, but I don't agree with that. What people would rather hear is whatever they're stuck in with their comfort zones. People that have been raised to think that suffering and misery and this and that is the only real reality will reject any information that's good or positive, whether that information is true or not being neither here nor there, they'll reject it. And people that have grown up in this blissful bubble that, all I can do is think happy thoughts, get all that negative away from me, you know, they'll reject anything quote unquote negative, whether it's true or not. So that's why on the illusion of bliss end, when someone tries to warn them, hey, there's this danger, go this way and not that way, or you're going to end up screwed. Shut up, you're so negative. But at the same time, the negative people, when you try to tell them there's this really powerful and positive empowering thing that you can do that'll help you fight your enemy, oh, shut up, you're Pollyanna, you're delusional, you're not speaking reality. The only reality is suffering and misery and death, and this is Satan's world. And it's like, well, wait a minute, if you really think this is Satan's world, why not help give it back over to God? Why are you unwittingly making yourself in alliance with Satan by perpetuating his shit? Oh, shut up, I'm Christian. No, you're not, you're a fool.
Dave, I have to say that I'm fading a little. It's after 11 here, and I'd really love to stay on the chat with you. But I feel like I might become a blithering idiot if I try to articulate my words any further.
Well, you know, maybe this is your opportunity to show yourself that you don't have to self-censor, and that if you view being tired as being relaxed instead of being exhausted, then your heart can speak more than your brain. Maybe this is an opportunity, not a burden. But if you want to go, we won't hold it against you.
No, it's been great, honestly, chatting with you all. And I'd love to come and chat with you all again. Thank you so much. Very insightful. And just nice to find that there are groups out there dealing with things on a realistic level. It's not the, Illuminati, big full-up, genocide level of things. It's okay, let's deal with things on a pragmatic, practical level. We are all going through shit on a day-to-day basis. Let's look at these things and look at where it's coming from. Let's look at our attitudes towards them, how we approach that. And I just want to say to you, Kristen, I'm actually amazed that you're 18 years old, because I'm thinking to myself, geez, I wish I was half as together as you are at the age of 18. So if that makes you feel any better about things.
Oh, I always tell her that too. I mean, you know, not to use a cliche of when I was your age, you know, but it's like I always tell her that she's got it way more together than I did at that age. But when she's in her victimization thing, then me telling her that just totally sounds like bullshit to her.
Yeah. Well, thank you both, Dave left apparently, but yeah, I mean, ups and downs as whatever has. I will admit, you know, I think that's a big reason why I might be so antisocial. I do see beyond a lot of things that most people get caught up in at this age. So that's one thing. But
yeah. The whole antisocial thing is something you're going to have to learn to get used to. Okay, as a young girl, I was very popular. I had loads of friends, more friends than I actually had time for. And as I've gotten older and as I've grown more intelligent and more discerning, the people that I trust have become less and less. But also, I don't need all that distraction around me. I don't need all the words and the energetics that come with these multiple aberrant energies. I've actually become more selective about who I choose to spend time with. And nowadays, I don't spend time with people who are ignorant, who are still in that old paradigm, because what I find is that when I speak to them, I scare the bejesus out of them, because I'm just so open about it. So what I do is I spend time with people who actually, are open to the conversations that I'm going to have with them and understand the world that I live in and that I move in. And trust me, that's a very few people very, very few people, and it gets fewer and fewer, but those people are quality. They're quality. It's not quantity anymore. And that's what you'll find as you go through this process. So it's not a judgment thing. You keep saying, oh, you're so antisocial, like you're judging yourself for it. For me, that's almost like the Buddhist who takes time out to be in silence and be with themselves. Learning to be okay with yourself is the first step to actually, you know, you don't have to seek others in their company to fulfill you. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And some people just aren't happy unless they just aren't happy, and there's nothing you can do about that. And yeah, that's not your fault.
Yeah.
Yes, and I will admit it is nice not having the drama. I hear about so much bullshit and stuff like that, and it can become, I am glad I missed out on that aspect, but I can't help but feel like I've missed out on a lot of experiences in high school due to not going out or not having fun, really.
You know, that's something that...
But,
how much fun you have is up to you or not. As far as not, as far as missing out on the ass rape, feel lucky, not bad about it.
Yeah. Yeah, but the fun's in your head. Trust me, my mind is my playground.
Mine too.
Yeah, yeah. We also used to judge ourselves for being anti-social.
Like as a kid,
we also judged ourselves for like moving through social groups, because as we grew, we would come into alignment with people and then fall out of alignment. And for so long, I thought that I was just using these people. I thought that like it was some bad part of my character that I would fall really into these people and I would get great benefit and then I would leave. And not realizing that I was providing great benefit as well. And so realize, Kristen, that when you are even more intentional about who you hang out with, that they are getting great benefit and you are providing benefits to people who are so on such a different plane than you that they can't even re-engage, and it's not any negative aspect of your character.
I've had to learn to stop being the metaphorical cat lady as Tobias Lars likes to explain it as, that whole, oh, I need to help everybody and save the world, because if I don't, I'm a horrible, terrible person. When you're the cat lady, metaphorically, you've got too many cats, and then there's all this poo and stink and urine. It doesn't help anybody. And I've had to learn to realize that there's only two types of people that I have the right to decide that I actually want to deal with: the ones who are already shifting, and the ones who really, really genuinely want to, but don't quite know how yet. I don't have to evangelize to the people that don't want to, that don't know what it is. I don't have to go and try to save them like some Christian zealot going, oh, you're going to burn in hell if you don't listen to me. And that I'm not doing anything wrong by focusing only on the people who are shifting and who genuinely want to shift. So therefore, they're not closed down to what I'm saying, that it doesn't make me a bad, evil, horrible person to just want to only have those people around me. That doesn't mean I'm doing anything wrong. Because if you try to cooperate with people who are not mature enough for that cooperation, I have a metaphor for that. It's like trying to have a group of kindergartners rebuild the World Trade Center. All you're going to have is a bunch of little kids getting hurt on power tools. You're not actually going to get anything done. So I had to learn that.
Folks, on that note, I'm going to say goodbye because I'm exhausted. So thank you so much for this wonderful conversation.
We have that effect on people, but we know you love it.
No, it isn't you at all. Honestly, genuinely, it's quite late here. So
I'm being playful. It's a part of my humor.
Well, thank you. It's been great to be with you guys. Right. Honestly.
Yep, we'll do this again soon.
It's nice talking to you.
And don't forget. Everybody check the PSEC Hangout chat thingy on Facebook. And anybody who hasn't added Melanie on Facebook yet, I would suggest go ahead and doing that, and vice versa. And the rest of us can still continue to talk a little bit until we feel like we're done. But Melanie is going for now. Thank you so much for being with us. And we will do this again.
I'd love to. Thank you so much. It's been great to meet all of you. You've all got such great dynamic personalities. I'd love to have more fun with you sometime.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Definitely.
Have a good night. Have a good night. We love you.
Love you too. Bye-bye.
I just wanted to add on the note of, you know, friendships and quality over quantity and all that stuff.
You guys are my quality. I love you guys.
Well, we love you too, Katerina.
Aw. I love you too.
We love you too. So.
We love you.
But,
You love me. Barney gave
Paul
me
loves you guys too.
I love you guys too. I love you too.
Everybody love you too, loves everybody.
But,
that's fun.
But, I just, it was an interesting context you guys gave me on friendship, because there's that paradigm that we all get kind of caught up in where we want to be friends with all of our old high school friends. We still want to kind of maintain this intimate relationship with everybody because, you know, if you can't be friends with everybody, they're not really your friends, blah, 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 blah. You know, all of that stuff cycles through your mind. I've had to deal with that here in the last couple of years. You know,
or like if you take time out for yourself to think and deal with your own shit, then you're not talking to your friends, and the more you don't talk to them, the friendship is being destroyed.
That sort of thing.
The
illusion,
that's literally what's been happening with me.
the illusion of all of that sort of stuff. The main thing
Kristen, you couldn't lose us if you wanted to. You're stuck with us.
We're like a hemorrhoid on your ass.
We're not going away.
Going away.
I've had one of those. Yeah.
Well, okay.
They're
no,
not fun. But I'm glad you guys are my.
I've had one as well, and no, they're not fun.
I've
never had one either. High five for the hemorrhoid.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Never had one of those, but you know it. Anyway, that's a health discussion.
Paul, you've got a detachable hemorrhoid called Katerina's fist. I'm kidding.
We could do the whole Dr. Oz discussion on poop and what the different shapes look like. Let's not go into that conversation right now. This isn't this conversation.
This is paradigm shift, you guys. Like an educational comedy. We need some comedy.
That's right.
When I get some more medical knowledge through my EMT classes, we can go to PSEC.
Everybody, welcome to the PSEC after party.
Yay!
Things
getting crazy.
But anyway, I just wanted to say it's an interesting concept to think about. You know, it's one of those kind of common sense things, but at the same time, it's not in a context in which we think about all the time. I have a lot of high school friends that I do care about, you know, that are out there. You know, a lot of them are in the service or in the military or just, you know, busy with work and busy with their life. And, you know, we're all kind of in the adult world now, and, you know, it's kind of a new thing, you know, and once you get out of high school, the world just kind of changes and people go off in their separate directions and different paths and people start going on their own journeys, you know, but the one thing I've noticed about life is, you know, people come into them for a reason and people leave them for a reason, because, you know, the people who come into your life and stay in your life, those are the people who are the most special and the most important, because those are the people who are going to be around regardless of what happens. You guys are the kind of guys that, you know, you're the group of friends that everybody wants to have, because you're the kind of people that are going to be sticking around forever, you know. There ain't going to be no getting rid of this friendship right here, you know. But as to the temporary friends, you know, that Dave's talked about, you know, I appreciate all my high school friends and the relationships I've had with them and still kind of sort of have through Facebook. You know, it's kind of a limited interaction, a post here, like a post there, but, you know, they served their purpose in the time that they needed to, and, you know, if they exit my reality totally, c'est la vie, and if they stay where they are, well, c'est la vie, and, you know, I'll still be as supportive to them as they're open to, but, you know, It's just one of those things. You eventually come to that realization that you don't have to, you know, not everybody has to be your friend. You have your special group of friends, and then you have those other people that are just, you know, they serve the purpose and the time they served it in, and they're no longer there, you know?
And then a part of helping the friends out that, you know, are on the closer level that you mentioned. And I think this is a topic that we've never gone into on a hangout. Of course, now my dad is calling me on the other line. A topic we've never really gone into, and I think this would be perfect for the PSEC after party here, is the idea of what I've coined as benevolent trolling. In other words, using positivity, trolling with positivity for a positive outcome. And we're all quite the benevolent trolls, but we've never really had a PSEC episode like discussing what all this benevolent trolling is. And like for example, just to let you know, Katerina, what?
I remind me that I want to tell you about the Paradigm's Paul face last night with a lady and how I was talking about how I wanted you. I was sharing with him like how you were with Fencewitch and how you were with dealing with other things. Like, remember the lady in the hostel when I came to visit you? And like he had an experience where he had a crotchety old woman, you know, call him a liar at his gallery. And, you know, he didn't really like say anything back. And he kind of allowed that paradigm to be the authority, but now he understands that he can actually benevolently troll in a situation like that. He doesn't have to take on the feeling of being a liar or that projection from this woman, but he can actually play with the reality.
And by the way, I'll tell you more about this later, but phase one of the next step of benevolently trolling Rochelle DeYoung back into her power empowerment has begun. Money has been exchanged. Richard put forth the 1 year DeviantArt subscription, so she'll be getting notification of that. So the amplification of positivity will be there for Rochelle. And so as far as your contribution to that, as we discussed that it's going to be for the three of us, we'll talk about the details of that. But I've preemptively put forth our part of it, and then you can deal with me on the rest later. But I just wanted to let you know that that has been done.
Cool.
Stage one has been initiated, so that should be interesting. Gotta spread the love.
Yes. Cool.
But I will be right back. I need to go see what my dad was calling me about, so I'm going to see what's up with that. I will be back in a moment, so you guys talk amongst yourselves. Oh, and it looks like Kristen dropped. I don't know if she's going to be coming back or if that's a glitch, but I'll be right back.
Synchronicity, bye. So now it just gets to be you and us, Rich. I've always wanted two big cocks in a room.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the after party just turned into the after orgy. Oh my.
Yeah.
It's always the women who are precipitating the orgies.
Yeah, we're salacious.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
We just be sitting here chilling in the corner like, oh, come on. Oh, what the hell? Whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, mainly at this point, I've gotten past all of the meat of a lot of that stuff to do with relationships, especially to do, you know, Natasha's, as I've told you guys, has been a huge reflection to me on that one. And, you know, at this point, I'm just kind of okay with just going with the flow and just doing things in the moment and just.
So is Natasha Russian by any chance?
That's a Russian name. She's not Russian. I actually did. She has like two different last names, but one of them is like Italian and English, and then the other one is German and English. But
okay.
I don't know which actual name she goes with. What actual name she goes with?
But you want to make it Hamilton.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that's, at this point, it doesn't appear like it's going to be that. I mean, she just posted this thing about her current boyfriend. If the last person you kissed was the one you had to marry, would you be happy? And she just said, yes, please, with like these two heart face things, which, you know, if she's happy with that person, great. But, ooh, that looks good.
As I was talking about sharing kindness and abundance with people, that phone call was about kindness and abundance that was waiting for me in the phone of me not knowing that food was being made and given. And mm-hmm. So I've been gifted food abundance here.
Nice.
Yeah, I've been munching and nibbling on pizza, but yeah, when it comes to more personal relationships, I mean, you guys are like the if I was going to have a guide, you guys are like probably one of the best guides that could probably ever be gifted to me, period, because you guys have the dynamic of what a relationship should be and what I think every couple would want to strive for in a relationship, mm-hmm. that open honesty, authentic communication, you know, that's something that I want to have. And I want to have that relationship that, you know, with a woman that is absolutely fabulous on Facebook, you know, not just the Facebook image, but I mean, just that, you know, that sort of image that people can look to for inspiration, like you guys do. You know, you guys actually aren't just a relationship. Oh, look at us. We're so beautiful. We're so high and mighty. Like a lot of relationships are, you know, you guys are actually a relationship where you're not only interested in the health and well-being of each other and your own feelings in a relationship. And you guys have this spark of connectivity that's like, a connection that most people dream of, but you guys are interested in helping others that are in a relationship of their own and have the, you know, aren't in a relationship like me. You know, you guys are just like the literal definition of an awesome relationship. So, I mean, you guys are a blessing in of that sense, because you guys are the kind of people I've always wanted to have in my life, because you guys have what I think most people, what I think any human being that has a good heart desires for a relationship and for, you know, that interconnectivity with somebody that they really care about, you know? So I think you guys really do a public service in that regard, because you guys aren't like a lot of relationships. You guys aren't in it just for yourselves. You guys are in it, not only for each other, but for all the people around you that you really care about and genuinely mm-hmm. want to help, you know? Which if most relationships or majority of relationships were like that, the world would be a far better place. People would be confident. People would actually, and not only that, people who are single, if there were couples like that, that were, you know, kind of interworking with each other in that positivity, you know, helping others out, you know, I mean, freaking A, people that doubt themselves or have similar, you know, circumstances. I mean, those would be the perfect methods for other people to, you know,
divorce rates would be lower.
Yeah, divorce rates would be lower. People who are single would actually like, oh, hey, yeah, I know this person over here who would love to meet a person like that. And then, you know, you guys go, oh, we know Rich. Yeah, he's great. You know, this person sounds like they would be great. You know, they could, you know, and no neurosis, no none of that. Just, you know, friends being friends and just getting to know people. And, you know, if two people, you know, really have that compatibility, they're like two magnets, then it's like, well, that's a bonus, because it's like, okay, they naturally decided that they wanted to do that, but we helped facilitate energetically to bring that together. You know, it wasn't anything that was neurotic or like, oh, yes, the Queen of England and this arrogant prince over here are going to get married. You know, it's nothing like that. It's like, you know,
I must own her, Sieg Heil.
Yeah, it's nothing like that. You know, it's that total natural, beneficial, you know, how relationships should be, you know.
Oh, darling, I am your Ruth. Ooh.
Well, yeah, and this post I just read out to them, Dave, you know, that Natasha shared this picture thing, one of those memes or whatever. If the last person you kissed was the one you had to marry, would you be happy? And she's just like, yes, please. And I'm just like, oh, man. You know, it's one of those things, you know. I just realized the meme for what it is, and I'm not butthurt by it. It just is what it is. It's where humanity's at. And honestly, if Natasha doesn't ever come back into my reality, you know, I don't consider that something to victimize myself about.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do some celery juice.
I'm gonna go make celery juice, guys. I'll be back.
Oh. Alrighty. Mm-hmm.
See, that was just totally. It's that. See, it's stuff like that that's totally legit, Paul. You know, she's like, "You want some celery juice?" And you're like, "Yes." And she's like, "I'm gonna go make some."
Right, and there like, it is. And now we're gonna. Now we're both gonna have celery juice. It's gonna be rad.
Yeah.
And yeah. So I mean, like something that Katerina and I have really been focusing on is. Like when we started Money, Power, Sex, that was our first attempt at just like, fuck it, social media. We're just like, fuck it, let's talk about pedophilia and BDSM. And
oh, like, by the way, I was going to say this earlier, but for the audience listening, if they want to find your and Katerina's channel, go to YouTube and search Money, Power, Sex, Paul, Katerina. Put those words together and you'll find it.
And you'll find it. It's there. But anyway, Rich, as I was saying, so one of the reasons that we did that was because we were just so tired of being contrived and so tired of like looking at all the contrived stuff on the internet and the people who are like trying to tell you that they can give you all the things that you want in life, but coming to it from a place of, oh, I've already gotten those things, like I'm the guru, so come and follow me because I know what I'm talking about. And so Katerina and I were like, you know what, like let's just talk about our relationship as we have it, because every single day There are challenges. Every day there are triumphs. Every day there are blessings. Every single day there is new things. And man, like, you forget about them. You forget about all the good in your life. So when we document it, it's so great. Like sometimes I'll be led to watch a video that I made a year ago, and I'll be like, good Lord, that's my life now. Mm-hmm. So look at all the things that have changed, and it's fascinating. And now we're tackling spirituality, and we're like, hey, listen, like this is our particular flavor of spirituality. Take it or leave it, but look at the results in our life and decide if you want those. This is what we do, this is what we get. Instead of, I'm the guru and I have been doing this for years, or
You will burn in hell.
Right. This is what you always do, this is what you always get. Like I don't always get what I expect in life. There are all kinds of points and times in life when I'm like, good Lord, why is this happening to me? But because I'm so committed to growth, I'm so committed to expansion, it's totally okay. I'm like, I've learned to see the good in it. And like right now, I mean, we have a channel called Money, Power, Sex, and right now I don't entirely know how my rent's going to get paid. So am I some money guru? Nah, mm-hmm. Not really. I'm just a dude figuring it out. And I'm a dude going into it with great and ironclad faith. I mean, I work in an art gallery. We've got stuff on the wall for $250,000. Somebody is going to walk in and just grab it, and I'm just clearing the resistance to that. And the reason I'm doing it is because it's evangelical in nature. I can say, hey, listen, this is how I do what I do. This is what I do. If you like to, like, I mean, I'm talking about the specific paintings that I'm going to sell, and I'm going to. And that way, when it happens, I can come back and say, hey, remember when I didn't know how it was going to happen? Well, this is how it happened. This is what I did. And I feel like that's the best way to help the world is you get people who like the result that you're achieving and want to achieve the same result. And then you just teach them exactly the thing that you do. It's very simple.
Hey, Paul.
Let them take it or leave it.
In all fairness, social justice warriors always get everything they expect. They expect the butt hurt, they get the butt hurt. So if you want to always get everything you expect, be a social justice warrior.
There you go.
The butt hurt side of the force.
I'm a social justice commando.
See, and that's the one thing that I think, and I'm not saying this out of a point of arrogance, Paul, don't misinterpret what I'm saying here.
It's my love.
Okay, Google just garbled that to hell. Oh. The thing is that I see with a lot of relationships, especially like in the instance of Natasha and her boyfriend, Max, they, you know, it's a meme that I notice. It's that meme of like that self-centered kind of like, it's all about us, screw everybody else. we're all in it for ourselves. You know, everybody else go away. You know, if you're interested in who we are, you know, our relationship dynamic, you're a bunch of weirdos or perverts or whatever. You know, it's a self-destructive meme that I notice within a lot of relationships that's not only detrimental to people around them, but it's a perpetuation of that same old meme that is neurotic and dysfunctional in and of itself. And not only that, that attitude towards others is just that quantum mirror kind of like internalization of what they're dealing with and what they're
you can't have friends and a boyfriend. And if you think you can, you're a creep.
Well, yeah, exactly. You know, and that's what I noticed with Natasha. It's really sad, you know, and you know, I feel sad for her. You know, I sympathize with her. You know, it's one of those things, and you know, it's really refreshing to at least see one couple out there like Paul and Katerina who aren't that way, who aren't, you know, that neurotic, you know, oh, we can't have any friends. We've just got to be there for each other and screw everybody else. You know, they're not that way. Yeah, exactly. See, look at Katerina. She's telling it like it is. Like, fuck that shit. We don't do that.
Yeah. Friendship is creepy. Get that away. Yeah.
You know, but the way you know, Katerina knows, because Katerina sent that friend request. The way Natasha's acting is that total rejection of everything else in her life, because you know she has this paradigm of I can only have one or the other. I can't have both, and I'm not worthy of both. And if I have both, then that's scary, and that totally defies everything that I've ever been taught. That totally defies, I imagine, the teachings of the current church that she's going to. I mean, you know, she treats.
I can have my pizza hangout and my chicken dinner. So fuck anybody who doesn't think I can.
Yeah, and I can have delicious Domino's pizza and a pizza hangout, and equally on that note. You know, it's like we live in this society that's based on one or the other. You can't have both. You can't have your cake and eat it too. It's like, well, yes, you can. You have to believe in that. Just like you know, we can't constantly believe this neurotic old lie that we're never going to get to a Star Trek point in civilization or even beyond that. You know, we've got to make that reality happen, and it's by doing small little acts like this that gets us one step closer.
Oh, Dave, you're so rude for eating on camera. Great, you feel that way. It's my privilege to make you feel triggered because I'm giving you what you want.
Oh, Dave, you're so arrogant, and you know you know too much, even though you've never studied it, and blah, 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 blah. You never went to school for it, so therefore you are arrogant.
Have you guys noticed, though, that the more that you guys shift, the less that shit's happening?
Mm-hmm. I know.
It's so cool.
Well, what
Crimson Flake is so quiet. It's great.
Well, yeah, and that's the thing. Like, I am so beyond Natasha's expectations that she can't even hardly stand talking to me. She can't say anything because I'm defying everything that her reality says must be. You know, she has this other boyfriend, and in the past, I would have been totally in rage mode. I would have been, like, grabbing that knife that Katerina has there and threatening to, like, you know, go to his place and fucking shank him to death or something crazy like that, even though I'd never do it, you know, but I don't, you know, it's not, I don't have that, you know, I'm just totally happy being who I am. And I'm totally respectful of Natasha's pace. I'm respectful of my own pace, respectful of Rochelle's pace. I'm respectful of everybody's pace now. You know, I realize everybody's
You're respecting yours.
I'm respecting mine, you know. I'm respecting mine. I'm respecting everybody else's. And, you know, to her, that just that reality doesn't exist. Oh, that rich is not the rich you're looking for. He does not exist. What he's doing is a ruse. That's it. Because I'm only worth having somebody getting into my pants and playing with me. Because, yeah, that's it. That's all I'm worth. Ah. But, oh yes, if that was the last person I kissed, I would marry them. Yes, please. You know, and it's like, oh shit, you guys haven't even been together like what, 6 months, and you guys are already talking about it. That's about as bad as I was all that time ago. I used to do.
Oh my gosh, guys, I have to share even this with you.
But
look at my I don't know if you can see that, but it says 1777.
1777. Yes.
Number synchronicities everywhere, man. That's how it is in my life. It's like 777. Here you go. Look at all these godly alignments.
By the way, I clocked out of work yesterday at 4:20.
Nice.
I looked at the clock and I'm like, 4:20. And I just clocked my number out. Then, like the day before that, I have a credit card that reads in the last number of 2012. Dave just drops off there really quickly. So now it's just me and you guys again.
I'll check this out.
Nice.
Same. Yeah, I was just sharing that with
them. The holy numbers of God.
I think it's cool to be able to ladder at the console exactly what you do today.
I know, and then giving numbers and synchronicities.
Yep.
Google be all like, fuck you.
So outside, my love, it's so beautiful. It's so ridiculously beautiful out there. We are going to have to go outside and enjoy the stroll.
Oh, we need to go do with our football.
Yeah, we're going to go play with our football.
We got a football. Show them the football I drew on. Show and tell, Paul.
So we have this Nerf football. It's so great. I went to Walmart to find a toy so we could like play, and I was like a frisbee or something.
The park, which is a fucking amazing park.
Yeah, we did this beautiful park where the grass is like carpet,
and it's right next to the ocean.
Yeah,
there's palm trees everywhere,
and tennis courts,
and it fucking feels like a dream.
Right, cool. It's amazing. Like, this is exactly the sort of place that
I want to go
play hang out.
Football and go have fun.
So, yeah, we have this really cool football here.
Football outdoors, multicolored sex toy indoors. There you go.
There you go. Woohoo! Yeah. Anyway, I just walked outside. It's so gorgeous out there.
So
I mean, perfect day. So, we're going to go and play football.
We never really got fully in depth into the subject of benevolent trolling, but I guess we can, we can go into that later. Although I did find it funny how,
I think it needs its own PSEC episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a really big concept, and I feel like we should devote two or three hours to it.
Yeah, and I feel like I also need a break. I want to get my feet stretched and go wake up, because we didn't really, we just kind of rolled out of bed and then got on this call.
We were up until 4 o'clock.
We were up until 4 o'clock in the morning just fucking around and having fun.
Well, you did pretty good for just rolling out of bed and getting on this thing. You did pretty well.
Yeah,
I know.
We did.
I know. Yeah, because we have our celery juice and our lemon water, and we have like fucking boundless energy.
The past Katerina wouldn't have been able to do it. She just said, Dave, I can't come on today. I just woke up. And
I know.
But you're just like, fuck it, I'm getting on.
Yeah, I even rolled out of bed and put on my makeup because I was like, I'm actually going to be pulled together and not just rolled out of bed like, bleh, you know? So anyways, we love you guys, and we're going to go make celery juice and play football.
Alrighty, well, thank you everybody for joining us on this crazy, insane, fun, informative episode of Paradigm Shit and Educational Comedy, and we hope you guys are having an enjoyable time wherever in the world you are, whether it's Central Time, Greenwich really mean fucking time, or whatever any other time. Have fun, and catch you later. Thanks for watching. We'll catch you next time.
See you later.
See you, everybody. Later.